You're watching ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week.
Griffin on fourth down. Flips one off his back foot for the end zone. Touchdown! Griffin kicks. Touchdown!
Griffin wants to throw and wants to throw deep. He's throwing for the end zone.
Does it?
Oh, it's gone!
Oh, my God!
Going downfield again. Could it be?
Unbelievable! RG3 does it again!
2011 winner of the Heisman Trophy is Robert Griffin III, RG3!
Heisman Trophy winner Robert Griffin III, red game as he tries to lead explosive Baylor to its 10th win. Washington can score two. The Huskies, led by first-team All-Pac-12 running back Chris Polk, look to pull the upset. Welcome to 2011 Valero Alamo Bowl as part of ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week. Tonight from San Antonio and the Alamo Dome, Baylor shoots for its first bowl win since 1992. Washington trying to win a bowl game for the second straight year. Hi, everybody, alongside Chris Spielman, I'm Dave Pasch. Robert Griffin III met with us yesterday, told us he has not made a decision about the NFL. He's graduated, Chris, but he is a junior by eligibility, so he could come back, but it could also be his final college football game. There are a lot of people who haven't even seen him play. What do they have to look forward to tonight?
Well, you're going to see tonight why Robert Griffin III won the Heisman Trophy. He does it with a lot of different tools. One is his physical attributes. Right here, you're going to see his vision. He has such a command of the offense. There's no panic. His vision tells him, okay, let the receiver develop the route. Wait a second, nothing's there. I feel pressure. Watch him. He'll roll out. And instead of making a young decision by tucking and running, which he can do, he keeps his eyes downfield and hits the open guy. Now, we talk about the other aspect of his game. Obviously, it's this. He's like a quarterback in a tailback's body. People think he's slight. He's not slight. He's 220 pounds, and he's all man.
Baylor, Chris, did lose three games, but that wasn't RG3's fault. The Bear defense struggled throughout the season, and Washington's offense is pretty potent. They got a good quarterback and a good running back.
Well, they had a record-setting year for their offense as far as throwing the football. They got a good running back in Chris Polk, over 1,300 yards. But what they have going for them right now is Baylor's defense isn't very good, Dave. They give up 477 yards, and they give up over 35 points a game. And this is something to watch. This truly could go to 1,000 total yards and over 100 points in this game. If that happens, me being a defensive guy, just get the camera on me after the game. I might take a nosedive off the top of the Alamo Dome.
Washington trying for its first eight-win season since 2001. Baylor looking for win number 10, which would tie a school record set in 1980. Kickoff next. Pac-12 meets Big 12, Washington and Baylor in the Valero Alamo Bowl. Dave Pasch, Chris Spielman, and now the third member of our crew, Quint Kesnick, down on the field.
Coach Art Briles of Baylor. Coach, what would a 10th win and a first bowl win in 19 years mean for the Baylor program?
Been a pretty good evening. You know, it's something we've been working for a long time. You know, we're here. We've got a great crowd behind us. Baylor Nation really showed up. We want to bring them what they want. That's a 10th win for Baylor University.
How do you best characterize the focus level of your quarterback, Robert Griffin III?
You know, he's a very disciplined person, very dedicated. His focus is never an issue. He's ready to play football.
What's your number one point of emphasis right now?
Just, you know, be us. Do what we do. Do it both sides of the balls and special team. And then just get out here and play the best that we can play.
Thanks, Coach.
All right, Quint. Now, recent history has favored Heisman Trophy winners in bowl games. Cam Newton, Mark Ingram, each winning their bowl after capturing the Heisman. As you look at Steve Sarkisian, like Art Briles, has done a pretty good turnaround job at Washington. Remember, before he took over in 2008, they were winless. Back-to-back bowl appearances now for the Huskies. Baylor has won the toss and elected to receive, so we'll see Robert Griffin III in moments. Antoine Goodley and Levi Norwood are back to receive the Eric Folk kickoff. It'll be Norwood about 2 yards deep, and he will not make it to the 20, planted at the 15-yard line by Quinn. Court Dennison. Our impact players brought to you by Chick-fil-A, Robert Griffin III. 9 rushing touchdowns, 36 passing touchdowns, only 6 interceptions.
You can describe this offense as explosive, and right there is the most explosive player besides RG3. Kendall Wright, over 101 catches this year. Watch out for the deep ball, and if you want to run the football, you have Terrence Gannaway, a good power back. Coach Briles challenged him this offseason to get tougher. Guess what? He answered the challenge with his performance this year.
RG3 last year in the Texas Bowl threw for over 300 yards, but his team lost to Illinois. And a little trickery on first down, but Washington not fooled as Kendall Wright is spun down by Dennison for a loss on the play. See a lot of formations, a lot of shifts, men in motion. And we saw the run play by Wright, but he lost on first down about 8 yards. And now Griffin on the rollout, being chased from behind. And you see the arm strength as he completes it to Tevin Reese at the 32-yard line. A flick of the wrist, and the thing travels fast and far.
Well, it reminds you of a quarterback right now by the name of Michael Vick of the Philadelphia Eagles. You see that off balance, yet he does have the arm strength and the whip of the arm to get the ball off balance but get it 25 yards down the field.
Here's Gannaway with his first carry, met in the hole at the 35-yard line. So it's a gain of about 3 on the play. Sean Parker made the tackle. Griffin, the first Baylor player to win the Heisman. He also won the Davey O'Brien Award for the top quarterback in the country. Cam Newton won both last year. A lot of people comparing Griffin to Newton. As Griffin fires incomplete, trying to hit Terrence Williams in the middle of the field. It'll bring up 3rd and 7.
Boy, one of the problems that Washington is going to have, they're so big up front, they're trying to substitute. But as the game goes on, you're going to see that Baylor prides itself on how fast they operate. We talk about a team that operates fast normally is Oregon. Baylor says they're faster than Oregon. At least Washington had Oregon to prepare for this Baylor-type speed of plays.
There, Griffin on 3rd down, dumps it off, and it'll be a 1st down as Monk takes it out near midfield for a 15-yard gain, brought down by Parker.
All right, we're coming here with a zone pressure. And a good job by the Baylor offensive line of picking up the pressure. And Robert Griffin III, one of the biggest throws, it's his mentality and understanding the offense and knowing where to go with the football.
And a quick toss out on the flat to Tevin Reese, and he's run out of play. The Baylor coaches want a penalty flag on Richardson for a late hit, but won't get it, and it's a 5-yard pickup.
You know, Washington, you understand you're playing an offense that can move the football. Don't panic. Their number one goal is not to give up anything over their head or the big play.
Griffin under center and off play action. Throws another strike, and it's a 1st down catch by Lanier Sampson.
You see again, Dave, the accuracy of Robert Griffin III and the understanding of the offense, reading the defense, simple zone coverage, understanding that the 8-yard out will be wide open versus a 3-deep look.
And Griffin again to the sideline. It's Kendall Wright. School record 101 catches on the season, led the Big 12 in receiving yards.
Now they're a machine. Now take a look this play. Watch the Washington Husky defensive line. They will get no push because they are dragging right now because of the tempo of the Baylor Bear offense.
They've run 8 plays in less than 2 minutes. Here's number 9. Gannaway powers to the 19-yard line for about 4, dropped by Parker.
You see right there, and the number one way to tell that a defensive line is getting tired as they try to substitute is that they stand straight up on the snap of the ball. They don't play low.
There's Griffin on the run, and he gets clobbered after a gain of 1. Dennison leading the way. And a lot of people were concerned going into this year about Griffin and his stamina. But as you see, early in his career, he looked more like a track runner, but he's a solid 220-pound guy.
We saw him yesterday. He's a thick Nick. I mean, he really did a good job. The offseason, he came in at training camp at 225.
And had trouble with the snap there. Perhaps wasn't ready for it, and still throws a 1st down completion to Kendall Wright. There is a penalty marker down. A legal man downfield there. ACC officiating crew, Ron Cherry, our referee.
Well, then an eligible receiver downfield, number 79. It's a 5-yard penalty. We'll replay the down.
That's on Robert T. Griffin, no relation to RG3. Yeah.
Robert T. is getting a little bit of a hurry because this ball is supposed to be kind of a quick screen. You see Robert T. had a little pull and trap. It was a shovel pass or a run option with RG3.
But how about Robert Griffin III rolling left and then putting it on the money?
Well, he's done that. Well, I mean, there's not a throw that he can't make. And it's the arm whip and the velocity of the football. He's a natural throw.
On third and 9, gets hit and delivers a strike. Short of the first down, though, is Samson by about 2 yards. We'll see what they do on fourth down.
Well, I think you go for it. I absolutely think you go for it. The only thing that stopped them so far is a mishandled snap.
And they will go for it on fourth down with a long yard.
Yeah, Washington's not even lined up, Dave.
And Galloway gets the first down because they weren't lined up. Just runs right through the Washington defensive line.
The coaching staff down in Washington are all looking at Nick Holt, and the reason why is you can't try to substitute. They will not let you substitute. The defensive line's looking at the sidelines, and they're not in the stance, and they're standing straight up and getting blown off the ball.
Holt, the defensive coordinator. 5 first downs already on this drive. And here's Wright into the end zone. Touchdown, Baylor.
Give it to your playmakers. But right now, Kendall Wright, explosive, powerful, and knows how to find the end zone. And RG3, any layover laps? I see none. I see perfection out of him in that first drive.
And as the extra point is good, everybody talking about Robert Griffin III as a first-round pick. Kendall Wright, according to many scouts and GMs, a first-round pick as well. It's his 14th touchdown catch.
Brian Burr in studio. Got a wild basketball game brewing over on ESPN2. Florida and Rutgers. Eli Carter for 3. Ties it at 76 in overtime. The freshman Brad Beal for Florida loses it. One final chance for Rutgers, and we are going to double overtime. Over on ESPN2, tied at 76. Dave?
Who knows? That could be the final score of this game. Boy, Robert Griffin III on that opening drive. His only incompletion was a drop. 13 plays in less than 4 minutes, and they went 85 yards.
So efficient. And the problem is what they're doing is isolating Kendall Wright out there on Richardson, and right now that's no matchup.
Aaron Jones will kick off. Sankey and Callier back for Washington. And both players grab it. It's Callier across the 20-yard line. And drags 2 defenders past the 30. Our impact players brought to you by Chick-fil-A. Washington has a record-setting quarterback in Keith Price, school record for completion percentage and touchdown passes.
Austin Safarian Jenkins, a freshman tight end, will occupy linebackers and safeties, which in turn should help the outside receivers of the Huskies. And also Chris Polk, 1,300 yards, tough inside runner, good football player.
Over 700 career carries for Polk. And Price on first down. And has a completion to a wide open Devin Aguilar. Stiff arming his way inside the 30 and out of bounds at the 26-yard line. Gain of around 50.
You better make sure if you're going to gamble, you try to make a play. Right here, you see the poor angle taken by Sam Hole. And Aguilar does a nice job of keep working. And Keith Price showed patience and allowing that route to develop. But playing safety, you're always, guys, deep as the deepest. Rule number one.
Got 42 yards there. And they're already at the 26-yard line of Baylor. First carry for Polk. And he is knocked down at the 23-yard line, a 3-yard pickup. K.J. Morton on the stop.
Washington here looks like they're trying to run a little bit of a tempo, no huddle offense, giving Baylor a little taste of their own medicine. Not quite as sound as Baylor's doing it.
Now Baylor was snapping the ball at about 28, 29 on the 40-second play clock. It's at 16 as Washington snaps it. And everybody covered downfield, so the dump off to Polk. He takes out a defender and wrestles to the 18-yard line. It'll bring up third down and short. Chadwick, the linebacker for Baylor, got the worst of that. Polk, solid 225-pound tailback.
And low man always wins. Rodney Chadwick coming up from his linebacker position. You got to keep your feet moving. On contact, a lot of times when guys tackle, they stop their feet and lose all the power.
Full house here, mostly a Baylor crowd, just about a three-hour drive from Waco. Washington on third down and two, and they handle to Polk, who was the first man through. He's got the first down and a gain of five to the 12-yard line.
A little bit of a change-up of look right there for the Huskies. Coach Sark puts Polk at the fullback position. You have to be aware of that. Figuring they're going to give the ball to the guy that's carried it for over 700 times in a career. A lot of different formations that the Husky offense will throw at you.
Keith Price, a sophomore, replacing Jake Locker. They're a top 10 pick by the Tennessee Titans, and there was some movement up front. And also a defender came into the neutral zone. We'll see what they call here. Baylor without its top defensive lineman, Tevin Elliott, due to a knee injury.
Offside. Defense, number 13. It's a five-yard penalty.
That's on Tracy Robertson. They don't have a lot of pass rush to begin with, but without Elliott, that won't help against this potent Washington offense.
What the Baylor defensive line will try to do, they try to do a lot of full four-man slants and angles, because they're not overly powerful up front, especially at the end position.
So it's first and five. And it'll be Polk straight ahead. Slammed down just short of the first down marker by Robertson, so it'll bring up second down and one. Washington got off to a great start this year, struggled down the stretch, still finished with seven wins for the second straight season, 5-4 in Pac-12 play. They won the Holiday Bowl a year ago, beat Nebraska.
This is a different type of offense as Baylor's Baylor defense. I guess if you were to compare the Big 12, it'd be like playing Texas A&M, a little bit of a power running game.
Here's Polk hit in the backfield. Swarm back at the five-yard line. Chadwick and Lloyd leading the way. It'll bring up third down for Washington.
Well, if you're having trouble stopping the run, especially inside run, you do have run blitzes would make it a little bit difficult for those big offensive linemen of Washington pick up, plus the angle and movement. Baylor will not sit still in these stationary targets. They'll move. They're forcing the big guys to move to match the quickness off the ball. A little bootleg action wouldn't be a bad idea right here if you're Washington.
They go empty as they motion Polk out of the backfield. Price looking that way. Now he'll run and he'll score. Touchdown, Washington. Boy, two defenders in the middle of the field moved to their left when they saw Polk go in motion.
Automatic alert for a Baylor Bear defense. Anytime you're empty and you have a mobile quarterback like Price, you have to alert the quarterback draw. What I loved about that play, and you'll see it on a replay, is the patience of number 17, allowing those people to clear, trusting his linemen, seeing the hole, hitting it.
And the point after by Folk ties the game at seven. Talked a lot about Robert Griffin III and his athletic ability. This guy's pretty good too. Sophomore Keith Price with a rushing touchdown to tie it. The graphic and the position of Terrence Lloyd, a perfect marriage to describe what's happened so far. In fact, Lloyd threw up while he was on the field before that last Washington play, then came over again and regurgitated on the sideline. Quick tempo by both schools as Keith Price, it's his first rushing touchdown of the season after Robert Griffin III with a passing touchdown for Baylor.
One way to slow the game down. Guys are tired. If I see that happen on the field, boy, I'll tell my offensive quarterback.
Run right at him. Here's Goodley on the short kickoff. And Goodley past the 30-yard line. All the way to the 37. Good starting field position for Baylor as we go back to the studio and Ryan Burr.
All right, Dave, checking in over on ESPN2. Double overtime. Rutgers behind 31 from Eli Carter. Up a deuce on number 10, Florida. 44 seconds to go in double overtime. Dave.
All right, Brian. Robert Griffin III, only one incompletion on that opening drive. And his 37th touchdown pass, fourth in the nation in that category. Here comes a pitch by Wright to Salubi, who's got the first down to the Washington 45. Second time Wright has taken a handoff. This time he pitched it to Salubi.
Yeah, right here. Just an option right here with Kendall Wright. And look for our former colleague Urban Meyer to have that in the playbook for the Ohio State Buckeyes. We saw Nebraska do that this year. It's the option after the option.
Gannaway runs into an offensive lineman and loses yardage. Good penetration by Danny Shelton, true freshman defensive tackle.
You see the adjustment right here, the matchup that would concern me if I'm Washington's right at the top of your screen with Kendall Wright on Quinn Richardson.
Griffin, incomplete. That's the second incompletion. Both have been drops. Now Griffin took a shot, still got that ball out there. It should have been complete. Desmond Trufant on the coverage.
You see Court Dennis, or excuse me, number 37, Fumaono coming in off of a blitz, and that's what Nick Holt's trying to do to create some pressure so that Griffin does not have all day to pick you apart.
RG3 told us yesterday he'll talk with his parents and Art Briles, the head coach, after this game and make a decision on the pros as he has a completion right at the first down marker to Terrence Williams. We'll see if he's short. They've already gone for it on fourth down once, and looks like he's just shy of the marker. And not even a thought of a long field goal. I mean, they're lined right up, ready to go.
God forbid we think about even punting here.
And Griffin handing it off to Salubi, and Griffin out there helping his running back, throwing a block, and Salubi scores. Touchdown, Baylor.
Just watching RG3. He's getting more excitement out of the block that he threw than any touchdown pass that he threw.
He almost outran the tailback, too, who was in front of him initially. Second touchdown run for Salubi. And the point after makes it 14-7 Bears.
Take a look here from Skycam, a beautiful angle. It's a zone read where Robert Griffin III is going to have the option to keep it or pull it. And right there, he doesn't even make him have a choice. He's running with the hole, to the hole with the tailback. You see the block that he throws to spring for the touchdown. And look how long he holds that ball in there. Then he finally reads the defensive tackle, who's the unblocked player who threw a no-hitter on both guys. Then the key block. That's why the players respect him. That's why he's a leader. That's why he has presence. And that's why he's your Heisman Trophy winner.
I apologize for the technical glitch we had. But as you look at Robert Griffin III already with a touchdown pass and then a block there to help spring his running back for a touchdown. If he should leave and go to the NFL, should he be the second quarterback taken, and where would you take him?
Well, I would take him. I think Andrew Luck is the first guy. I would take, if I needed a quarterback, I'd take him anywhere from two on up. And the reason being is because you take a look at the success that Cam Newton had this year. That only helps Robert Griffin III, a shotgun quarterback. Now, if you do take him, the thing you have to be concerned about, how's he going to adjust to the dropback game off of center and reading defenses? But you have to also tailor your offense to his skill set. You got to be committed to that.
Here's Sankey. And a good return for Washington again. Sankey on past the 30. We did see Griffin under center on one play, off play action, turn his back to the defense and throw a strike. So he has put that on display tonight, along with everything else.
Well, again, I think you're going to see with the, you know, the success of Cam Newton this year and natural throwers. Art Briles told us about Robert Griffin III. He saw quarterback first, athlete second. Well, he's one of the few coaches that saw that when they recruited this kid when he was coming out. A lot of guys saw athlete first, quarterback second. Not Coach Briles.
Briles, pretty good track record.
Yes,
with quarterbacks.
Is.
Kevin Cobb, Case Keenum, he recruited at Houston. And Price going downfield, and the pass off target. Intended for Aguilar, who got deep on the last possession. Price couldn't hit him this time.
It's just a bootleg throwback. Aguilar does have a step, just a hair short. Keith Price does have the arm to make that throw. Coach Sark told us, I asked him what the ceiling was on Keith Price, and he said very high. And once he gets over his injuries, he's also a dual threat quarterback.
He has had some knee problems, didn't start one game this year because of it. They'll hand it off to Paul, dragged down in the backfield by Tracy Robertson. Loss of about four.
It's a good job of the Baylor defense getting on the hips of the pulling linemen. You see that? They don't commit up the field too fast. They see those big hogs and their big rear ends running to the side. All you do, Dave, is focus on that hip, and you follow that offensive lineman and use your bursting skills of defensive lineman to trail and lay out and make a tackle. Big playmaker, the true freshman, Kason Williams, number two, in the slot. Explosive.
Price with time and a double coverage. Incomplete. Should have been picked off by Mike Hicks. Polk, the running back, was the intended receiver. It's fourth down.
Boy, he had Kason Williams, too, on the seven cut, which is a quarter route, about 17 yards to the sideline. Kind of forcing the ball. I believe he had it predetermined in his mind where he was going to go. He did not scan the field.
Kendall Wright, the return man, letting it go. And Baylor will start this drive inside its 20. You want more? Robert Griffin III, you're going to get him in about a minute. 14-7 Baylor.
College football, the Valero Alamo Bowl, is brought to you by Valero, the all-American gasoline, all across America. The new Capital One cash card for people who want 50% more cash. And Ford, drive one.
Now, both teams having fun. A lot of times, one team or both teams not happy about their bowl placement, but not the case with these two schools, given the fact that prior to last year, it had been 16 years since Baylor went to a bowl game. And for Washington, it had been an 8-year drought until last year. Both schools hoping their programs are on the upswing. A lot, obviously, will depend on the quarterback, especially for Baylor. If Robert Griffin III is back next year, he has graduated. He does have another year of football eligibility. He'll throw here to right on first down, makes a couple of nifty moves and gets cracked at the 25-yard line. Gain of close to seven. John Timu with the hit for Washington, and Wright shaken up on the play. They go empty set here on second and four. And Griffin trying to find a running lane. Stepped out right at the first down marker. Chased out by Princeton Fui Maono. They're going to measure here.
Injured player for Washington. I hope the play is okay, but there is, you know, one benefit to that. If you have to, you don't want to see anybody get hurt, but the benefit is what it does it gives your other 10 guys a chance to regroup and catch their breath. But on that run, you just saw the burst in speed of Robert Griffin III. I mean, it's an amazing speed that he has. Remember now, he was an Olympic 400 hurdle guy, quality. And when you have that kind of speed and athletic ability, and you put the arm in the head, what you have is a future pretty darn good NFL quarterback.
Fui Maono is the man that's shaken up. RG3 was injured, had a knee injury in 2009, bounced back last year, threw for 22 touchdowns. We talked with Art Briles yesterday about, you know, when did you get a sense that Robert Griffin could be a Heisman candidate? He said, I've been telling him that for a couple of years, that he's got the ability to win the Heisman Trophy. I don't know if even late in the season a lot of people thought that was realistic, but then he put on a show against Oklahoma, threw for almost 500 yards and 4 touchdowns. They beat Texas. First time in school history beating those two schools, Oklahoma and Texas, in the same season. And that seemed to clinch the award for RG3. On third down, he gets the first down to the 34 for about 7 yards, tripped up by Ta'amu.
Well, the thing about, you know, Baylor's offense, you think, you look at the completion percentage of 72%. If you haven't seen this team play, you think it's dink and dunk. It's not. It's downfield passing.
And another first down catch for Tevin Reese, wrestled down by Parker at midfield. Gain of 16 and a first down. Robert Griffin III's parents, both retired sergeants in the U.S. Army, on hand. Robert's fiance and his sister also here tonight. Here's Gannaway on first down, and he rumbles to the 43 for a 7-yard gain. Rebecca Litico, RG3's fiance, as Gannaway is stopped short of the first down by Dennison. We again apologize for technical difficulties. I think the thing that stood out, and this is the second time that we've had a chance to talk with Robert, we did their bowl game last year, Chris, is the character. And for those of you that heard the Heisman Trophy speech, it's easy to see why America has fallen in love with him. And you know, we asked him yesterday, you know, how's your life changed? He said he really can't go anywhere without people asking for autographs. In fact, he said the saddest story was there were actually parents that are adults that were telling children in wheelchairs to go get the autograph. He said he'd give a child in a wheelchair an autograph, and then 5 minutes later, he'd see the child running around. It just kind of tells you the craziness of what his life has become. We even asked him, hey, does Robert T. Griffin, even though he's not your brother, does he go out and pretend to be you? And he said it's been great, but he doesn't want to take the focus away from the program. That's one of the reasons why he hasn't talked publicly about whether he's going to go pro or not.
Well, you think what he means to Baylor and what this does for Art Briles as far as recruiting. I mean, you have a Heisman Trophy winner. You're the coach of that Heisman Trophy winner. Baylor's on the map. Art Briles told us what Robert Griffin III has brought to the table is the fact that now certain recruits that would never answer the phone when Art Briles called, now they're getting return calls, and plus they're getting a bunch of Facebook hits. And so he means a lot to Baylor in that program.
Court Dennison, the injured man, left, so to Togi, the linebacker, is it's Gannaway getting the first down inside the 35-yard line. Boy, third and two, fourth and two, really nothing for this squad.
No, it's just a nuisance, to be honest with you.
Griffin pulling it back. Penalty flag down, and a pass through the hands of the intended receiver, Terrence Williams.
It's a nice job by Quentin Richardson, number 28, matching up with Kendall Wright. His tough duty all night. He won that battle, but they'll keep coming back to that matchup.
68 offense. It's a 10-yard penalty. We'll replay the down.
That's a left tackle, Cyril Richardson.
See, right here will be the holding call on Richardson. Just double team and helping out. Number one goal. Protect your Heisman Trophy winner, even if you have to make a good tackle which is good in football, but not if you're offensive guard.
Corey Dennison, by the way, back in the game. Here comes a double pass. Wright, everybody was covered, and Wright going to take off. And good job by Washington's defense. Andrew can clean over there and takes down Wright for a minimal gain.
Nick Holt told us they were certainly aware of Kendall Wright's ability to throw the football. Good job of knowing your beliefs and instilling it in your defense to be aware of the trick play.
Yeah, he's got a touchdown pass. As Griffin finds Sampson along the sideline, stepped out 2 yards short of the first down. So it'll bring up third down.
You know, people say, how do you stop this type of offense? Well, you can draw any X's and O's up you want. You got to have the Jesses and the Joes.
Here's Ganaway. And he's right at the marker. Brought down by Gilliland. Had gone for it twice on fourth down and haven't even discussed it over on the sideline. So even if you're short, they're going.
And right now you can see that Baylor has, if you're matching up athlete for athlete, offense versus defense, 11-4, there's no matchup. I mean, Baylor's dominating athletically and talent-wise.
They've got 11 first downs. Washington, meanwhile, has run only 10 plays. Baylor's run 28 plays in the first quarter.
I told you. 1,000 yards of offense.
He's short, so it's fourth down. Remember, we had the Outback Bowl a few years ago where Northwestern and Auburn both ran over 100 plays, but that game went to like triple overtime. Baylor's going to hit 100 plays here in regulation at this rate.
Well, that's what they want. They control it. And they get the play in so fast. And it's a good job of coaching them, and it's communicating. When you get those guys operating at your level and everybody's on the same page, you can operate and get the ball snapped in 25 seconds to go, or 24, or 20, depending on when the play clock starts.
Fourth down and one. Quarterback sneak. And it looked like Griffin had it initially. Should be a first down.
Good surge right over his center, Phillip Blake. Number 74, low man wins. You see the nice surge right there. See how low Phillip Blake? You just lost him in that big pile of rear ends right there. But Phillip Blake from Ontario, Canada, of all places.
Chris, you've been calling for a quarterback sneak on fourth down and one all year. And we finally got it.
Yeah, believe that. It worked.
Baylor 3 for 3 on fourth down. Griffin 12 of 14, 118 yards passing, in trouble here. And doesn't go down. Griffin inside the 10. Heisman touchdown. Wow, Robert Griffin III. Even his family can't believe it.
Dad's saying, yeah, that's what I thought. A
little shaken up as well. My goodness, what a run.
It's speed, man. It's pure speed. This is playing at a different level.
10th rushing touchdown this season for Robert Griffin III, and the point after makes it 21-7.
Well, actually, they had the right defense. But we talked about athlete for athlete. Come make a play. You're going to see right here a chance to, on the sack with the zone pressure. Three guys missed the tackle, and this is something you can't coach. Williams does a good job of blocking downfield, but when you have speed and a determination and almost, to me, a desire and willingness to make the point, I won the Heisman. Here's why.
And look at his feet, too, in the pocket. Kept those things churning. Took a shot at the end from Sean Parker.
Well, a couple things, David. We talked about this. I talked about it at the luncheon yesterday. bowl practice, one thing that lacking in bowl games early on is poor tackling. You had three guys that missed the tackle, three guys with an opportunity to make a play at a Heisman Trophy winner. It started with Timo off the zone blitz. Nick Holt had a good defense called. They had him stop. Timo comes in. He throws a no-hitter. Two other guys run into each other. Then you have the speed and the block by Terrence Williams never quitting on the play. And the result is success.
Jones to kick it deep. Sankey and Callier back for Washington. Sankey scoops it up at the 10. And rolls to the 27. Capital One Bowl Week continues Friday with a full day of college football at 10 Eastern on ESPN. Iowa looking for its fourth straight bowl win, taking on Landry Jones and Oklahoma. Capital One Bowl Week on ESPN, ESPN3, also streaming live on WatchESPN.com and the Watch ESPN app. Like Robert Griffin III, Landry Jones, a junior, who has not announced yet whether he'll return to college or go to the NFL. People projecting him, though, as a mid-round, a first-round pick, I should say. Aguilar knocked down by Mike Hicks after a gain of about four.
See Washington right here trying to counter now. You want to give your defense a little bit of rest, but they're going to hurry up because I think they think that Baylor.
Here's Polk wrapped up in the hole after a gain of a couple by Chadwick. It'll be third down for Washington when we start the second quarter.
Won't answer with tempo, but right now they've countered well on the defensive side as far as matching Washington's tempo offense.
What a first quarter for Baylor's offense. And Heisman Trophy winner Robert Griffin III. A touchdown pass and a touchdown run. Baylor ran 30 plays in that opening period. Our game track brought to you by American Airlines. Baylor on pace for 1,000 yards of total offense. They already have 13 first downs. Robert Griffin III with just two incompletions. And those two were catchable passes. He also had that ridiculous rushing touchdown.
Also a pretty darn good block that led Salubi into the end zone.
Now, what's the key for Washington here, Chris, to stay in this game?
One is to try to keep their defense off the field. Now, I know they're going a little bit of up-tempo. I would scrap the up-tempo. Run your offense because your defense can't hang. And if you try to go up-tempo, then Baylor could put up 120 if they wanted to.
They're 2 for 3 on third down. They need 4 yards here. Price with time and has a completion. Jermaine Kearse to the 46-yard line for a 13-yard gain.
Well, here you go. They're going tempo, and it seems like after a big play, what they'll do is try to hurry up and snap it. You have to get Polk on a little bit of a roll right here.
They have Callier in the game at running back. Price stepping up and going downfield. And the pass overthrown. He and Kearse not on the same page. You think of all the great quarterbacks that have played at Washington. Warren Moon, Mark Brunell. The Hewards, including our own Brock Heward, Marcus Tuiasosopo, who was a high draft pick, spent a long time in the NFL.
Chris Chandler.
Yeah. Cody Pickett. Keith Price has the school record for passing touchdowns in a single season and completion percentage set this year. 29 TD throws, 67% completion rate. And not much here on second down and 10 for Polk. Maybe a yard. It'll bring up third down and long. And in there for Baylor was Ahmad Dixon.
They have to get their play action game going a little bit because it seems to me every time Polk's in the ball game, you're getting those linebackers and safeties up close to the line of scrimmage. You have to hit them with play action. Try to get over the top because they're sneaking awful close.
Play clock is at 5. Third down and 9. And Price has a catch inside the 40-yard line. It's Kaysen Williams, the true freshman you were talking about earlier. 33 catches during the regular year.
Well, I love the route right here. Kaysen Williams does a good job of selling upfield, pushing the corner. K.J. Horton, who comes back late, and a nice route by the true freshman, setting it down and coming back to the football.
Well, they got him. They got Safarian Jenkins, a tight end, who's a true freshman. Scouts are already talking about him, as here's a wide receiver screen, and Williams dragged down after a gain of a couple by Sam Hall.
You have to look at it, Dave. I'm telling you again that the safeties for Baylor are playing about 8 yards. 7 yards across the board. They have nobody in the middle of the field. If you can get somehow down the middle of the field, those safeties are sitting so close, you're wide open. I'm telling you, a play action pass could be there. Watch the safeties. You see right there's a line of scrimmage, and we'll see where they line up now. The line of scrimmage is right at the right around the 36, so they're about 8 yards off.
Instead, the pass deflected, and Price could not catch it on the redirection, so it's incomplete. 3rd and 9.
Now, if you're 3rd and 9, they're going to, that play action has to come on 1st or 2nd down. 3rd and 9, we'll see what they come with. But normally, they'll be a little bit more of a conservative position as far as lining up deeper.
And they picked up 3rd down and long twice already on this drive. It's a run play. Pull, big hole down the middle. First down all the way to the 20. A 16-yard run.
Boy, nice job of the offensive line and a good call by Coach Sark right here. Linebackers are dropping out, expecting pass, which allowed the offensive line to generate momentum, get a body on the body, and Chris Polk knows what to do with it when he gets a hole that big.
Third of the Pac-12 in rushing, 16th in the country. First team all Pac-12, Chris Paul. He's already graduated. He's a junior in terms of eligibility. And you got a sense from the Washington coaches, even though no decision's been made, that this will be his final game as a Husky. He's going to the NFL. He's a receiver here, and there's contact and a flag. As two defenders ran into Polk, who is in the route coming out of the backfield.
That was the counter of the safeties playing tight, Dave. Right there, they faked the screen to Williams, and they were hitting Polk on a takeoff route. That was a good call. That was wide open. Baylor was smart to get interference, or it would have been 6 points.
Pass interference. Defense. It's a spot foul. Automatic. First down.
But that's what we're looking for, the tightness of the safeties. How do you loosen them up? Right there, you see the safeties jumping inside, and they have to get the pass interference. That was a great call by the Washington offensive staff because of the safeties' tightness, like we pointed out. That's how you get them back, and that's where you will attack them.
K.J. Morton committed the interference penalty. Well, first down, Washington inside the Baylor 15. It's Polk off the right side, can't find a crease. Grabbed from behind by Tracy Robertson. He's had a good day, saved the offside penalty earlier.
Well, that's twice that Tracy's made that tackle when the pulling guards getting on the hip and following the pulling guards down the line of scrimmage. That tells me nobody's getting the backside cutoff block. You have to be able to reach him. So whoever's responsible, usually it's the center or the guard, when you have the guard tackle the play side pulling, you got to cut him off up from the backside.
And Price looking to throw. Everybody covered. And now Price going end zone. Touchdown! James Johnson. How about Price keeping the play alive there? And that's his 30th touchdown pass, adding to his school record.
You can see why the future looks bright for this young man, Keith Price. Again, using his mobility not to run, which he could have, but to buy time to allow Johnson to clear the back of the end zone and throw the perfect strike, rolling to his left.
Similar to Jake Locker, right, in his athletic ability. That's who Price replaced as the Washington quarterback. Point after gets Washington within seven. Price a rushing touchdown and now a passing touchdown. Robert Griffin III is not disappointed in his first game since winning the Heisman Trophy.
Well, you can see what he brings is the intangibles. We see it with his arm. And right here, this shows you the type of teammate he is, the character that he has. And that will show up on GMs who want to draft this kid, that he'll do anything for his team. We saw his arm strength earlier. And you see this, the willingness, the determination, and the power. One of the questions marks that I was asked was, is he slight of build? And if you look at him, he's thick-legged. He's muscular. He came into training camp at 225 pounds, and you saw the power that he brings to the table as far as running the football.
Goodley and Norwood are deep. And Norwood will bring it out. And brought down at the 20 as we check in with Ryan Burr in the studio.
All right, Dave, here's your Sports Center right now. Had a great basketball game earlier today. Rutgers and Florida went to double overtime. Eli Carter going for 31 points. Rutgers upsets number 10 Florida 85-83. Champ Sports Bowl, Florida State 18, Notre Dame 14, Seminoles 18 straight in the second half. Dave?
You know, you were talking basketball earlier, Ryan. There's Kim Mulkey, coach of the top-ranked Baylor women's team, and Baylor's men's team still undefeated after a last second win last night against Mississippi State. Things pretty good right now in Waco. And if you're a Baylor Bear fan, they're 12th in the BCS in football, highest ranking ever. As Griffin pumps and throws a low pass that time, incomplete, intended for Terrence Williams. Second down.
A lot of double moves for the Baylor offense. It's something that's a mainstay. They get you on the little dinks in the play action. You saw Robert Griffin III pump, then they'll try to hit one over the top.
They'll run Gannaway on second down. Wrapped up at the 27-yard line. Gain of six. Court Dennison led the Pac-12 in tackles, made the stop. Third down for Baylor. Gannaway, a 240-pound tailback, set the school record for rushing in a single season. He's got 33 yards in this one as Griffin just bolts past three defenders before he's touched and picks up the first down for Baylor. Are you more impressed with his ability to run or his ability to throw the football so far?
Well, there's missed timing.
Yep, second time they've had issues with the snap, penalty flag down. Gannaway recovered the loose ball. Go ahead and finish your point.
Well, I saw him as a true freshman. I did the Baylor versus UConn game. And that's when Terrell Pryor was a true freshman.
Building a substitution offense. It's a 5-yard penalty.
And certainly Terrell Pryor was pretty darn good. You're going to see the bad snap right here. It's just miscommunication, something that they're normally in queue with. And I saw this kid play. I said, man, this guy is just such a natural throw of the football. Then when you watch him run, he's only gotten better as a runner because he's gotten bigger. He's gotten smarter. And he has great vision. He has great vision as a passer. And what he's worked on and developed is his vision as a running back. Now, you imagine him running this type of offense, and you see a Cam Newton. As a flag is thrown.
Building a substitution.
Wow, back to back.
The offense broke the huddle with 12 men. That's a 5-yard penalty.
That's a sixth penalty already on Baylor. Back to back illegal substitution penalties. It's first and 20.
Now, here's a point to think about, Dave. I mean, you see the success that Tim Tebow's having. Tim Tebow, maybe the greatest college football player of all time. All right, so you put a Robert Griffin III into an offense like the Denver Broncos system. And the ability of Robert Griffin III throwing the football compared to Tim throwing the football, you have a pretty good weapon, wouldn't you think? And it'll almost be worth if we commit to that type of offense.
Griffin will keep here, and he's out across the 30. Brought down by Sean Parker.
The only thing you're concerned about is what? Can he take the shots?
Well, he's bigger than Michael Vick, and Vick is about 200 pounds and has gotten hurt a lot.
Yes.
But even if you're not running option, there are a lot of NFL teams that run shotgun passing offenses as Griffin gets out of trouble here on second down. And Washington able to slow him up enough where he stumbles out of play around the 40.
And that's a frustrating thing for Washington. I mean, they're getting hands on him, but you're seeing just the burst and the ability to escape. So eventually then Coach Holt, the defensive coordinator, Nick Holt, is going to have to sell out and blitz, because the last time they blitzed, they had him nailed in the backfield to miss tackles where he broke it, made it pay for it with a 30-yard touchdown run.
Washington comes in 116th against the pass in the country, 94th in total defense, and they're trying to stop Robert Griffin III. Was accounted for almost 200 yards of total offense already. In trouble here, his arm hit. Griffin gets out of there, away from one man, finally goes down, sacked at the 33-yard line. Josh Shirley able to catch up to him.
You can see a nice little stunt right here. They have an X game between the defensive line. You see everybody, the inside guys switch up. It's too late, and just the pressure and the effort, keep bringing it, keep bringing it, keep bringing it. You see Shirley there on the wrap up, but that was a nice call. Show blitz back out of it, but you run stunts and movement with a big offensive line, and Baylor could not handle it.
Fewest punts in the country, and this is their first punt tonight.
That's like a touchdown for the Washington defense right there. It really is. It's a stop.
Cason Williams, the deep man. Spencer Roth, a true freshman. And backs up Williams. And he is spun down at the 22-yard line. So Washington with a touchdown on his last offensive possession. And the Huskies making plays on defense to get the ball back. Opportunity to tie the game.
College football, the Valero Alamo Bowl, is brought to you by the GMC Sierra. Now during the GMC holiday event, trade up to the best Sierra ever and get some of the best offers of the year. And Domino's. Oh, yes, we did.
A lot of people happy the NBA is back, including the Baylor and Washington players. They got to take in the Spurs Grizzlies game the other night. Defensive coordinator for Washington, Nick Holt, is cousin of the San Antonio Spurs owner Peter Holt. Two are very close, spent Christmas together. Price off play action going downfield, and it's pulled in near the 50-yard line by Callier. And a gain of close to 28 yards.
Again, first down. Baylor's committing their safeties at 8 yards. Where do you attack? Right down the middle of the field. Callier coming from a tailback position. Runs through the middle of the line of scrimmage untouched. Good job by Keith Price. Boy, he's impressive now. For a sophomore, he's only going to get better.
7-4 this year as a starting quarterback. Missed one game due to injury. Here's Paul off the left side. And he gets crunched at the point of attack by the safety Sam Hall, the leading tackler for Baylor. Only a gain of one for Polk.
Good job by Baylor right there, slanting their whole defensive line. Take a look. Watch the whole defensive line slant this way. They have a read. See that? They're getting movement in position, and that's how you counter. If you're a little weak against the run, that's what you counter, is movement up front by all four guys slanting to the tight end.
They go empty, and the throw underneath to the tight end, Safarian Jenkins, and I had 6 touchdown catches during the regular season. True freshman, 6'6", 260 pounds.
Somebody that they have to account for. Anytime you have a tight end that's a threat, it puts pressures on linebackers and safeties, which allow your wideouts a little bit more freedom to work.
Washington 5 of 6 on third down. This is 3rd and 1. Play action. And Price going deep into double coverage. Incomplete. Aguilar, the intended receiver. Did you like the decision to throw the bomb on 3rd and 1?
Yeah, I like the decision to throw it on 3rd and 1, because what's the difference if you give Baylor the football here? You have to go for it. You make this decision with in mind that you're going to go for it on 4th and 1. Absolutely, I like it. And good coverage by Baylor, staying deep as the deepest.
They will go on 4th and 1, just inside the 40-yard line of Baylor.
You got to sneak it. Bryce is a good runner, a long body. Go ahead, sneak it, get the first down. Also, you have the hard count available to you. You got right here, poke at fullback, normally the tailback.
They gave it to him earlier in short yardage. They'll do it again. And Polk able to muscle his way through the arms of Elliott Coffey and get the first down.
Now, they will have a play off that off short yard should we get into it. Maybe a little bit of an option look with Collier.
Washington huddling, keeping Robert Griffin III on the sideline, also giving its defense a breather. But you're right about Price. He's been impressive. 9 of 14, 130 yards, a touchdown pass, also a rushing score. He'll throw here on first down, and wide open inside the 20-yard line is Curse. They finally catch up to him and drag him down at the 6. It'll be first and goal, Huskies.
Well, I love the offense using the whole field. You see Curse right here. The corner jumps inside chasing. You're having two guys. The corner vacated his zone. That's a lack of discipline. As soon as he saw that inside route, he passes out to safety. Then you have to sink back on Curse. He lost the vision. You saw him right there. KJ Horton sneaking inside and peeking, which cost him. Pass it off to the safety. Get back to your area of responsibility.
First and goal for Washington. And Price trying to dump it off, and it's incomplete. It was a forward pass, obviously. Don't know why Dixon has taken off running with it. Safarian Jenkins, the intended receiver, like a tight end screen. He would have lost yardage had he caught it.
The right idea, but Baylor had the right defense. It's the right idea because of the play action, but Elliott Coffey does a good job because you're playing man-to-man coverage. Sitting there right on the tight end, not going anywhere. Everybody's locked up on a man, and that's discipline. A lot of times as a linebacker, you see that handoff fake, you were jumping to make the tackle, vacate your coverage. He was disciplined and holding the coverage.
You see the trip set here at the bottom of your screen. And it's Polk straight ahead down to the 1 yard line. Coffey on the stop along with Hall. It'll be third and goal for Washington from the Baylor 1.
And spread the field. You saw those three wideouts out wide. The reason being is to get more defenders removed from the box area and give it to your all-time leading rusher to hit it up inside hard.
Opportunity to tie the game. Third down and goal at the 1. Play action, rollout, and a dump off. Diving into the end zone is Aguilar for the touchdown.
The play action pass, again, a good call. Price being patient. Aguilar knowing the guy's coming low, does the somersault for 6.
Second touchdown pass for Price. He also has a touchdown run. And we're tied after the PAT by Folk. Devin Aguilar with his 5th touchdown catch of the year. Keith Price matching RG3 in performance so far. The DirecTV mobile studio makes its way to the Alamo in San Antonio and will conclude its trip in New Orleans at the Allstate BCS National Championship, which is, of course, a rematch from a game played during the regular season. You picked your winner yet, the BCS Championship, or are you still mulling it over?
Oh, I think Alabama's going to win. I think it's going to be a great game. I just think it's tough to beat a great team like Alabama 2 times in 1 year.
Norwood and Goodley are deep as Washington has bounced back from a 14-point deficit to tie the game. And Goodley threw a seam at the 20, able to get outside. And Goodley carries a defender with him all the way to the 38-yard line. Justin Glenn finally tracks him down. Let's look at our quarterback spotlight brought to you by Dove Men Plus Care. Robert Griffin III. With 2 total touchdowns, and he also had a key block on the other Baylor touchdown. 3 incompletions, and you could argue that those were drops, all catchable passes. He's not disappointed.
There's no argument. They were drops. No argument whatsoever. Absolute drops.
They go by the same guy, Terrence Williams, number two.
How about Keith Price, quarterback for the Huskies, answering the challenges, drive after drive.
Here's Salubi out of the backfield with blockers in front. And Salubi stepped out, but after he got the first down, and a gain of 13 to the 49 of Washington. By the way, Princeton Fui Maono is done for the day due to injury. Court Dennison, another Washington linebacker, was hurt earlier but has since returned. And here comes another potential double pass instead, right taking off as the initial toss was behind the line of scrimmage, and a gain of about 8 yards before Parker makes the tackle.
Yeah, that wasn't that's a fake potential double pass. You see those four guys out there with Kendall Wright sitting behind them. All they are is lead blockers.
It's rare to see five receivers in the game at one time, much less all next to each other. As Griffin is sacked and the ball comes out, it's recovered by Timu of Washington. Oh, a turnover by RG3, and the Huskies take over. Andrew Hudson with the strip sack.
Coach Andrew Hudson, number 93, working upfield, does a good job initially of getting stopped. But Robert Griffin III has to make a decision. You know that pocket's collapsing. Either throw it away or tuck it and go. That time, that's on number 10 right there. That's on your Heisman Trophy winner. You're holding that football too long. Make your decision, either run it or throw it. But don't just stand there and do nothing with it. Hudson does a good job of finishing the play, using the left arm to club it out of there.
Now Keith Price retakes the field red hot. The two touchdown passes and a touchdown run. He'll throw on first down. And he gets out of there. Spins himself to the ground at the 50. It's a gain of 7, though, for Price.
Yeah, the 49 gets the credit for the tackle right there, Dave.
Who does he remind you of when you watch him?
I haven't watched enough of him yet, but what I like is I think, to me, he's a capable runner, but he's become a pure pocket passer, and he's got a better pocket presence because of the injuries, which has forced him to become a pocket passer because he couldn't run. Like, he has the ability to run because of the injury. So he's only becoming a better pocket passer as the year went on.
Going to hand it off to Polk here on second and short, and Polk will get the first down. Slicing through the Baylor defense. Coffey got him to the ground at the 45. Washington with all of its timeouts. 3:15 on the clock here in the first half. Well, we mentioned that Baylor had 245 yards in the first quarter. Now it's Washington's offense getting it going here in the second quarter as we are on pace for over 1,000 yards of total offense between the two.
So we talked about at the beginning of the game that Washington didn't panic when it got 21-7 because Baylor gives up 35 points a game. That was pitching a shutout in the earlier game of the year.
Here's Polk on the draw trying to find a hole. He does. And Polk gets the first down. What a great run to the 31-yard line. A 14-yard gain.
Well, this is Chris Polk. He runs angry right here. A good sign of a running back. Watch this. Shoulders forward. Always keep your legs driving. Keep moving, fighting for every yard. Just look at the demeanor of the Baylor sideline and the Washington sidelines. You get two stops for that Washington defense, those are victories. The Baylor sidelines kind of look a little perplexed where the Washington sidelines hooting and hollering on a 4-yard gain.
From the Baylor 31. Price off play action, and the diving catch made inside the 20-yard line by Safarian Jenkins. He's down at the 15, a gain of 16 for Washington.
All their play action passes coming off these bunch formations. The true freshman right here laying out and doing a good job, turning thumbs up, snatching the ball with his hands as opposed to body catching. Might want to blitz here if you're Baylor, just to slow him down a little bit. Bring a little heat and a little pressure. Those safeties are awful tight.
And they got Collier here in the game as the Wildcat quarterback, and he's going to hand it off to Polk. No gain on the play as he's greeted by Chadwick, but Collier was in the game playing QB on that play.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of a trend, and I don't get it. When you're moving the ball, you got Price as the quarterback, you're running your regular offense, we don't need any fancy schmancy. We got good stuff going on here.
Baylor calls a timeout because the Bears are hoping to get the ball back with time on the clock. Washington with a 2nd and 10, looking to take the lead on this drive when we come back. Tied at 21 at the Valero Alamo Bowl, but Washington in scoring position. Capital One Bowl Week continues Saturday, a full day of college football. Noon Eastern on ESPN. Ryan Tannehill, Texas A&M, taking on Dan Persa and Northwestern in the Meineke Car Care Bowl of Texas. 2nd down and 10 for Washington.
Here's a matchup I like right there, Dave. Seferian Jenkins against Elliott Coffey. Big linebacker, a smaller or a bigger tight end.
Price stepping up on the move, finds a running lane. Great ball fake, and Price dives for the end zone. Touchdown, Washington. Robert Griffin III saying, that looked a lot like me. And clearly he's in. Touchdown, Washington. That's his 2nd rushing touchdown. Also 2 passing touchdowns for Price. Oh, what a ball fake, too. And the extra point makes it 28-21. 3 scores without an answer by the Huskies.
Anytime you have a running quarterback, do not leave your feet when he's on the move, especially when he crosses the line of scrimmage. He didn't get 1, but he got 2. By getting 2, guess what? He collects 6.
And let's go back to the studio while we have a moment. Check in with Ryan Burr.
All right, Dave, coming up on the H&R Block Halftime Report, I'll be joined by Mark May and Lou Holtz. Champ Sports Bowl goes down to the wire. We will recap Florida State and Notre Dame with a thrilling finish there. The Rose Bowl has a hero before the game is even played. Wait to hear what happened out in California and a top 10 upset in college basketball. All coming up on the H&R Block Halftime Report, or after a couple more touchdowns, Dave.
You're not kidding, Ryan. Already had 7 touchdowns combined here in the first half. Both teams over 250 yards total offense. And you can make the argument which quarterback has played better here in the first half.
RG3 or KP1. Might go with KP1 right now.
His numbers are a little better. Here's a short kickoff fielded by Norwood. And Norwood past the 35, still going. And dives to the 42-yard line. January 2nd, it's a top 5 duel between 2 of the game's most feared offensive weapons, Andrew Luck of Stanford, Justin Blackmon of Oklahoma State. Both likely will be top 10 draft picks. It's the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl, Monday, January 2nd, 8:30 Eastern on ESPN, ESPN Radio, ESPN3, also streaming live. Watch ESPN.com and the Watch ESPN app.
I love Justin Blackmon. He's something. He's a guy every single week that does something to make you say, wow.
90 seconds and 2 timeouts for Robert Griffin III to try to take Baylor down and tie the game again before the half. And into Washington territory with 1 play as Reese takes it to the 45-yard line.
Well, he does have that flick, doesn't he? I mean, just that quick delivery, nice spiral, a lot of zip on the football.
He pumps, looking downfield, and Grant from behind and brought down. Shirley again. Came in with 5.5 sacks, 9 tackles for a loss. Redshirt freshman Josh Shirley made a lot of plays so far tonight. Baylor taking its 2nd timeout, 1:14 to go in the half. Back in a moment. Back in the Alamo Dome, Nick Holt's defense started to get more pressure on Robert Griffin III. They forced a fumble and got a sack earlier, and then they took Griffin down on the last play at the line of scrimmage for no gain. So it's 2nd down and 10, 1 timeout remaining for the Bears. 1:14 to go in the half. Down 7. They led 21-7. After 1 quarter, Griffin in trouble again, gets away from Hudson. And a diving catch made by Terrence Williams. at the 40-yard line. He's 5 yards shy of a first down. It's third down.
Well, Hudson's giving Cyril Richardson all kind of problems right there.
And Griffin stepping up. In trouble again and sacked again. It's Josh Shirley who has Griffin's number so far tonight. It's fourth down. They lost yardage there, so they'll take a timeout and make a decision here. Fourth down at about 9, 46 seconds left. The way Washington's offense is going, Chris, do you punt the ball or do you go for it?
I don't think you can punt the ball. I think you're too good. You know what you do. Go ahead, take your shots. You're in a bowl game. You're not playing for a league championship.
The Alamo Bowl record for most points and a half was set back in 2000. Nebraska playing Northwestern. 49 points combined tonight, and Baylor going for it on fourth down and 9 at the Washington 44.
New left tackle in, Dave. Richardson's out.
Griffin with time, and it's broken up. And Washington will take over on downs with 3 timeouts, 43 seconds, and the ball near midfield. John Timu with the pass breakup for the Huskies.
And Timu does a good job of playing and reading route recognition, rolling in with the receiver. The ball was late, and I'll tell you, the route was wrong. Why is the route wrong, Dave? 2 receivers in 1 spot. You see Wright and Williams run into each other. A lack of communication. That was on Kendall Wright. The ball was ready for Williams. Kendall Wright ran the wrong route. Never do you have 2 receivers in the same area.
And now you get Washington the ball near midfield with a ton of time, and the Husky offense on a roll. Here's Polk on the run. Big running lane. Polk inside the 30. He might take it to the house. He will. Touchdown, Washington. And, of course, now you second-guess that decision to go for it on fourth down instead of trying to punt and pin Washington deep.
You do if you don't have an explosive offense that can score 14 points in about 3 minutes. That's just how they're built. That's how they're made. That's how they play.
Polk with his 12th rushing touchdown of the year. He's over 100 yards this half, and he's about 100 yards away from the school record for career rushing yards at Washington.
First play, 2-minute drill. You got to be alert. Draw. Right there, you see nobody getting off blocks, nobody tackling. We told you at the start of the game, why is Baylor vulnerable in this football game? 477 yards. They give up on off for defense and over 35 points a game. Now, that 35 points a game included a shutout, I believe their second or third game of the year. I think it was against Stephen F. Austin. That's a lot of points, giving up 50, 60. You're never out of it. Now, Baylor's comfortable. Being down 14 points, it's okay. We'll figure it out. We'll get that back like that.
313 yards of total offense for Washington. 301 yards of total offense for Baylor. And the half isn't over. Robert Griffin III will get the ball back with 31 seconds left. But the Husky defense, in particular, their freshman defensive ends, have really stepped up here.
Yeah, both Hudson and Shirley playing with great effort. We talk about no huddle offense. We worry about the toll it takes on the defensive line. Right now, it's taking a toll on the offensive line.
Well, you mentioned Richardson was out. The left tackle, Kevin Palmer, was in on the last possession. As there's a short kickoff here, Eric Wolf, one of the up men, takes it. And he's brought down near the 33-yard line. Hey, fans, with ESPN's new football game, you're the most explosive player on the field. The return man. Hit the gap, break tackles, take it to the house. Play for free at ESPNReturnMan.com. And this certainly feels like a video game, the type of offense we've seen here so far in the first half with 56 points, a new Alamo Bowl record. You see the numbers for Robert Griffin III. He does have a turnover, a fumble that led to a Washington touchdown. 27 seconds remaining. The Bears out of timeouts. Clock will stop on first downs. And Griffin throws it away there. There was a receiver in the area. Kendall Wright again. Andrew Hudson got pressure.
I can't say enough about Hudson and Shirley. When you look at the leading sackers in college football, but let's look at the leading sackers in the NFL. I'll start with one, Jared Allen. Not the most physical specimen, but effort, effort, effort.
Yeah, that's motor.
It. Yep.
Out on the flat it goes to Williams. Got the first down and then pushed out. Clock stops, 17 seconds left. Aaron Jones, the place kicker's long is 48 yards, so they have to get to around the 30. They're at their own 47 right now. And another throw to the sideline. And again, nobody out there to defend Terrence Williams. Takes 6 seconds off the clock. Picks up about 15 yards. Now they're at the 39 with 11 seconds left.
Well, you understand that. They're playing soft. They don't want to give up anything over top. But you have to get off blocks. If you're going to play soft, you cannot get stuck on blocks with Baylor's wide receivers.
And Washington's going to call a timeout here on defense to discuss the final 11 seconds. Now, we talked obviously at the outset about Robert Griffin III, and he's had a terrific first half. Meanwhile, Washington's quarterback and Washington's offense, we said don't sleep on them. And both Polk and Price have made huge plays here, Chris, in the first half.
Well, again, we knew that Baylor could score points. And we talk about Robert Griffin III, the Heisman Trophy winner. He's not disappointed, but Keith Price, no panic, a lot of faith and trust. And I got to tell you that Coach Sark and his offensive staff are doing a great job calling the football game against a vulnerable defense. Baylor's defense has been vulnerable all year. They're suspect against the run. They're suspect against the pass. And Washington has done a good job exploiting both areas of weakness for the Bear defense.
And talking with Steve Sarkisian yesterday, he feels very good about where this program is. Struggled his first year after taking over for Ty Willingham in 08. Willingham won zero games, and here they are, their second straight bowl game. Here's Griffin, and not on the same page that time with his wide receiver, Lanier Sampson, so 7 seconds left.
Well, I think that's Sampson's fault. And why do I say that? Because you got to understand that Richardson's out there playing a double move, exactly what Sampson tried to do. Griffin's reading a single move route.
Quick throw to the sidelines. Williams trying to get yardage and then get out of bounds, and he does with 2 seconds remaining. So this will set up a reasonable field goal try for Aaron Jones. I don't understand why Washington is playing so far off there. You're just conceding 3 points.
You are conceding 3 points because you're afraid to death of something over the top. So that's what you're conceding. Absolutely.
Now he has missed 7 field goals, Aaron Jones. And he's 2 of 7 from 40 yards or longer. And this will be about a 42 or 43 yarder. And Washington will call a timeout with 2 seconds left.
I think that's smart. I mean, you don't like to see that, but you play your strengths. You get up there and press coverage, and they hit you with a crossing route or take off, and you know you can't match up with them athletically. Play off and concede the field goal.
Washington has not given up a big play down the field yet, and that really is the strength of the Baylor offense.
And that's the game plan that Nick Holt had coming in. Stay on top, stay on top, meaning always deep is the deepest. If they catch it, come up and make the play.
42-yard attempt by Aaron Jones. Try to put 3 more points on the scoreboard. And it's good. So a good rebound by Baylor after giving up 28 straight points without an answer. Here's Quinn Kestner.
Coach, down 21-7. What changed the momentum?
Well, we've been playing decent defense on first and second down, but we got a couple stops on third down, then the turnover, and Keith has kept his rhythm. He didn't get rattled.
How do you best describe the play of Keith Price?
Well, he's playing well, you know, and we knew coming in this would be the healthiest he'd been since the beginning of the year, and it's shown. He's able to use his legs some.
How are you all of a sudden able to get pressure on Robert Griffin III?
Well, we knew coming in this game that conditioning was going to be a big factor, and it's going to be in the second half, and you know, our kids have prepared really well for this one. We got a long way to go, though, that's for sure.
What do you emphasize right now?
Got to finish, you know. We got to clean up the things that need to get cleaned up, and we got to finish in the second half and start really well when we get possession in the third quarter.
Thanks, Coach.
Well, Chris called it. He said 1,000 yards and 100 points, and we're on pace for that. He's going to go get some more caffeine. I'm going to take a breath. Right now, Ryan Burr in the studio, the H&R Block halftime report.
You're watching ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week.
Call me the champ of the world. I can raise my
Welcome back to the 2011 Valero Alamo Bowl as part of ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week. Washington, thanks to a 28-point second quarter, leads at 35-24. And it's a disputable champ in that first half. Robert Griffin III, Keith Price, both made some dynamic plays at the quarterback position. Price accounting for 4 touchdowns, Griffin 3, and Griffin also had the fumble.
Well, I think both guys have played well. And one thing where Robert Griffin III got in trouble is holding on to the football. But some of the good things right here, just understanding, recognizing the defense, getting the ball into Kevin Wright's hands, a playmaker as soon as possible. And right here, Price making good decisions, give a little ball fake. Tuck and go, and says that now I'm healthy, I can also be a dual threat quarterback and use my legs to create points. And right here is the turnovers. That's where Robert Griffin III make a decision. Throw it, run it, but don't stand there, because you have great effort by the defensive ends, both Hudson and Shirley for Washington, that have been able to get the pressure and slow down that Baylor offense.
Heisman Trophy winner RG3 did have that touchdown pass, touchdown run, and that really accounted for another TD with that great block to spring Salubi. Help him into the end zone. Washington will get the ball to start the third quarter. Baylor looking for its first bowl win since 1992 and its first 10-win season since 1980. Will they get it tonight? Tackled at the 20-yard line is Sankey. That's where Washington will operate. Our first half stats brought to you by American Airlines. Don't want to hurt your eyes with this, but man, look at the total yards for both teams and the average yards per play. They set a record for points there first half in the Alamo Bowl.
Well, I overestimated the defense. I said expect 1,000 yards of offense and 100 points total. Right now they'll blow that out of the water.
Baylor ran 49 plays, 37 for Washington. Here's a pitch to Polk. And grab from behind. He did get back to the line of scrimmage, maybe got a half yard. Quinn Kestick now down to the field.
Dave, I spoke with Baylor coach Art Briles. I asked him about the 4th and 9 with 46 seconds to go. And I said, why'd you go for it? He said, we didn't get here by punting. He mentioned that Washington's done a nice job taking away the deep ball. He says we have to be more patient on offense. He looked up at the scoreboard, says 11 points, no big deal. My one concern in that second quarter was fatigue setting in really everywhere in this Baylor lineup.
That fourth down you're talking about, they went for it around midfield, did not get it, and on the next play, Washington scored. Second down and 10 for the Huskies. Here's a blitz, and Price gets out of trouble, and now throws deep downfield, and got a man! Curse on the run inside the 20-yard line. He'll score! Touchdown, Washington! With his third touchdown pass. He also has run for 2. It's an 80-yard strike to Curse.
Well, Phil Bennett called the right defense. But the one thing he needs to coach is that your players as defenders do not leave the ground when a quarterback is scrambling. And I'll show you that here in a minute.
Extra point makes it 42-24 Washington.
Watch the top of your screen. You take a look. You're going to have a little bit of a blitz coming right here late. What you do, you jump and leave your feet. You do not do anything but create space for the quarterback to buy time. And you see Curse, too much speed for hole, and they finish. And again, Price with composure, knowing where he is, not to cross the line of scrimmage, keeping his eyes downfield and finding the open receiver.
Well, you mentioned that, you know, coming into today, not a lot of people had seen Robert Griffin III in action. Not a lot of people had seen Keith Price either this year. And boy, that was a terrific play. Rolling left, seeing his receiver release, and then making the throw with a defender on his back. The arm strength to get it there.
Well, again, I mean, that Bennett, the defense coordinator, great call. Second down, you're running the blitz right into the play. But you do not leave your feet as defender. If you do, you're susceptible to big plays. You allow the quarterback to buy time to find the open receiver.
Jermaine Curse is now one receiving touchdown shy of the school record. Mario Bailey owns it with 30 career touchdowns. How about Washington with 5 touchdowns in 12 and a half minutes? They were down 21-7 at the end of the opening quarter. Norwood takes a knee, so Baylor will start this drive on its 20. Robert
Griffin III comes out for the first time here in the second half. And that first stanza, 18 to 24 for 192 yards and a passing touchdown. He also ran for one. Baylor's three losses this year came at Kansas State, at Texas A&M, at Oklahoma State, in games where their defense just could not stop the opponent. It's happening again here, but a ton of time left. And Griffin will throw. Kendall Wright, that play worked a lot at the end of the first half. They go to it here in the first play of the second half and get about 14 yards.
Nice job of Terrence Williams out there blocking for Kendall Wright. Explosive player. Tell you, you don't get those plays without receivers blocking downfield. Both teams have done a good job of that.
Here's the end around to Wright. And he is hit at the 42-yard line, just short of the first down. Second down and a yard for Baylor.
Nick Holt's guys are doing the right thing, and Art Briles said it. They're doing a good job of taking away the deep ball.
Here's Gannaway, and he powers past the first down marker.
Of Baylor's offense. We talked about that with Baylor. You got to understand, they're going to move the football. The one thing you do not want to do is give up over the top. Coach Holt preached to us about staying on top, being patient, always deep as the deepest, rally and make the play on the short throws.
Here's Gannaway again, and he gets about 3 yards to midfield. If you're Robert Griffin III, there's got to be some frustration setting in because what you like to do best is being taken away. So how do you handle that as a QB?
Well, what Coach Brown said, you stay patient, you give what the defense is giving you. You take that. And they're giving them short little screen passes. You got a free play right here.
Yep. Offside and going downfield. And the pass was on target, but Sampson was out of bounds. There's also a penalty flag downfield, likely for interference. So two fouls on Washington here.
I love the awareness of Robert Griffin III and Lanier Sampson. Free play, convert whatever route you have into a takeoff, knowing for sure that there's an offside, and it was pretty clear right there that Griffin III recognized it. Okay. They ran a fade.
The two fouls on the play have offside defense. That penalty is declined. They're pass interference, defense number 28. That penalty will be a first down.
And not all quarterbacks recognize that, right, Chris?
No, they don't. But right here, Quentin Richardson does a good job. Panicked a little bit because he knew he was late and probably did the right thing. Again, I bet you he's coached that, understanding that if you're behind with this offense, go ahead and take the interference because of the accuracy of the deep ball throwing by Robert Griffin III. Take the interference as opposed to the touchdown.
Here's a quick throw out of the flat to Reese. He's to the 30-yard line for about five. That was the 25th pass attempt, 26th pass attempt by Robert Griffin III. 72% completion rate. First Baylor Bear to win the Heisman Trophy. Last two Heisman winners have won their bowl games. And here goes Griffin III inside the 20, picking up the first down. Got about 11 on that run. He's got 58 rushing yards on the day.
Well, you see guys with different gears, but rarely is it so apparent to the eyes. He does have a different gear, a different burst level.
Griffin keeping, making one defender miss, and they finally get him at the 14 yards, but he picks up three. Anybody in the NFL that you look at, you mentioned the comparison to Cam Newton in the sense of the type of player he is and maybe the offense that would work for him. He's obviously not as big as Cam Newton.
He's a better Michael Vick at this stage. In Michael Vick's career as a college quarterback, he's a better Michael Vick at this stage.
Terrence Williams about a yard short of the first down. Now, when you say that, you mean a better thrower. How can he be a better runner than Michael Vick was?
Well, because he's bigger, and I think he can take more of a penalty. I'm just saying he has that ability. He's a better natural thrower, and I think he has the same type of running skills.
Here's Gannaway in short yardage, third and one. Appears to have it.
He's one of those guys, Dave, that runs as fast as he needs to run. Now, I do think if he gets to the NFL, the one thing he has to do is learn how to protect himself because he's taking some pretty good shots. Now, these shots pale in comparison
to what he's going to take at the next level.
And his parents on hand. Robert Griffin III initially went to, was going to go to Houston with Art Briles, and Briles got the Baylor job. Griffin followed. He's graduated, eligible to play one more year. That's the third time they've had trouble with the snap and trouble with the pitch, but Sarubi able to get in anyway. Touchdown, Baylor. There were two bobbles on that play, and the Bears still get 6 points.
Composure.
We just have a speed option right here. Nyberg does a good job of getting out in space. Good read by RG3. A nice finish by Salubi.
Second touchdown rushing tonight, third of the year. They might look further at this to see if Salubi
got on the field. The previous play on the ruling on the field is that we had a touchdown. The previous play is under further review.
Ron Cherry, our referee, and let's see here. That's a touchdown.
Yeah, nothing to review. He's inside. The ball crosses the plane before he comes out of bounds. 6 points.
Foot was inside the pylon as well. Let's bring in ACC official Jeff Heiser, who's in the booth with us. You worked as a referee throughout the season. What is the first thing that the replay official is looking at in that situation there?
What he's looking at is trying to see if the player got, in this case, he got his foot inside the pylon. That way it gives the ball his goal line extended.
So even though the foot came down outside, out of bounds, once he crosses, the foot crosses the inside of the pylon, the goal line is extended, so no matter where the ball goes.
Let's look at it here. See how he gets the foot on the inside of the pylon.
Enough to be, that's a touchdown.
So the ruling of the field is confirmed. Touchdown, Baylor.
It's a thing, Dave. They get down 14 or 16 or 8 or 9. It's not a worry for them because they know they can get it back in a hurry.
Extra point makes it 42-31, but can they stop Washington? Haven't been able to since the first quarter. They're back within 11 early third.
You're watching ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week.
And looking ahead to the Capital One Bowl on January 2nd, it's Nebraska and South Carolina. The Gamecocks looking for their first 11-win season in school history. Steve Spurrier, 7-10 in bowl games. Nebraska can run the ball. Had a couple of losses down the stretch. We saw Nebraska a lot, though, during the season, and they certainly have some talent.
I think Taylor Martinez improved as a passer as the season went on.
You got a terrific running back, Rex Burkhead, Alfonso Dennard, a corner, and many feel will be a first-round draft pick. Here's Collier for Washington, and he gets pinned at the 18-yard line.
Nice.
What a hit by Brody Trahan.
Oh, man, stand up and take it back.
Penalty flag comes in at the end, perhaps for excessive celebration.
Why, we finally fired a good tackle tonight. Should be excessive celebration.
There's actually two penalty flags down.
You see that head up? Wrapped his arms, Dave. Should give that guy a trophy.
Should I give you a napkin to wipe the saliva that's
well, what do you expect?
Your mouth
I'm looking
there.
At 801 total yards of offense with 11 minutes to go in the third quarter. I see a good tackle. I celebrate that.
Personal foul, but where was the personal foul? Was it on the tackle?
Personal foul, number six, on the kicking team. 15 yards, first down.
It was on Ahmad Dixon. He was not the tackler. Not sure where the hit took place, but it gives Washington the ball at its 35-yard line.
The only thing where that could take place is away from the football, away from the action.
Keith Price back on the field. Three touchdown passes, two rushing touchdowns. He'll hand it off to Polk, trying to get away from a couple of defensive linemen. He can't run down at the 32-yard line by Dixon. Coffee over there as well. It's a loss of a couple.
Baylor's not bad on their containment of the outside running game. They run pretty well. Where they've been vulnerable as far as running the football is right up the gut. Just a good job. And you see Jean-Pierre getting out there, not making a play, but making him run the hump, meaning running lateral to allow the pursuit to get to the football. Jean-Baptiste, excuse me.
Second and 12 at the Washington 33. And Price will pull it back and look downfield. Long throw and overthrown intended for Curse. It's third down and 12. It's only the seventh incompletion thrown by Price today.
Interesting call here for Phil Bennett. If you bring pressure, which you've been able to get there with pressure, but you haven't been able to finish, or do you drop back and defend the sticks? Make sure the ball is thrown in front of you. Break up and make the play. Let's see what Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator for the Baylor Bears, dials up.
Washington 6 of 8 on third down, and a lot of those third down conversions have been in third and long situations. They have to get to the 45. Price on the rollout will throw it right at the sticks, but it's off target, incomplete. Intended for Curse. And Washington will have to kick it away.
Remember in the first half, Washington's rally started with the first stop of the Baylor offense. Now maybe Baylor can regain the momentum set up by their defense actually getting a stop, where Washington had 6 touchdowns on 7 possessions.
Grasped to punt. And right is the deep man. And he gets hit inside his 15-yard line and down around the 12. Anthony Goburn there for Washington, a 52-yard punt, nothing on the return, and Robert Griffin III back on the field. He's thrown for 217 yards and a touchdown. He's also run for 61 yards and a touchdown.
So this is where Art Briles has to stay true to his word. Stay patient. Understand that Washington is playing the deep ball and taking away all deep routes. You just got to keep dinking and dunking them and go the long way. And hopefully Washington is playing the fact that maybe they'll make a mistake or somebody will make a big play, cause a turnover like they did the first half.
To your point, a lot of people assume that that is the type of offense Baylor is, dink and dunk, but not the case. As Griffin hit and down he goes, a loss of about 3. Court Denison firing in there to make the play for Washington from his middle linebacker spot.
Well, also Everett Thompson for the defensive end. That's a zone read where you have to be able to give that ball away. That was a bad read right there by Robert Griffin III. Reading the defensive end crashing, he should have handed the ball off if he read the defensive end properly.
So second and 13. Ball inside the Baylor 10.
Look how deep the safeties are. You have Sean Parker 20 yards from the line of scrimmage. Can't even see him in your picture.
And RG3 moving to his left. Now going to fire deep in the double coverage. Broken up, incomplete. Intended for Kendall Wright. Quentin Richardson made the play defensively.
I'm going to tell you something. This was there early. Kendall Wright's open, but again, Sean Parker coming in late to the screen, and Quentin Richardson does a good job of finishing the ball underthrown by RG3 because he's rolling to his left, throwing back across his body. If Kendall Wright stays away from Sean Parker, runs to the outside, running toward Robert Griffin III, they're dancing the end zone for 6 points away from the free safety on the backside.
Griffin on third and 13. And the pass out of bounds, fourth down, so consecutive three and outs.
Wow.
First time all day. And Baylor will kick now.
And he went away against his own advice coming out of the locker room of the second half to stay patient. And what do we see? A long ball, because they had the screen set up anytime they want it. They have it for 5 to 10 yards anytime.
So So true freshman Spencer Roth will kick from his end zone, and Kaysen Williams, another true freshman, is deep for Washington. Williams backing up, fields it at his 38-yard line. He's in the Baylor territory. Williams breaks a tackle. Inside the 20, all the way to the 17-yard line. Spencer Roth, the punter, in there on the tackle. Great return by the true freshman, Kaysen Williams.
One of the problems is no hang time right here, which gives him time when they're set up. And when you don't punt a lot, you don't cover well. And right there, you can see a good job of executing by the Huskies. And the hand is not laid on him until he gets inside the 20-yard line. And the punter was the first guy to make contact.
46-yard return. It puts the ball at the 17-yard line of Baylor. Polk will get another carry. And he fumbled the ball. Baylor's got it at the 11-yard line. Huskies turn it over in the red zone. Nick Johnson stripped it, got off a block, forced the fumble, and the Bears recover it. Rodney Chadwick with the recovery.
Good job by Nick Johnson fighting off the offensive blocker. I tell you, it's all about effort. Play that two technique. Win your individual one-on-one battle. But don't give one for one. Keep fighting, keep grinding, and rip at that football. You'll get it out along with your partner, Sam Hall.
College football, the Valero Alamo Bowl, is brought to you by Taco Bell. Think outside the bun. And the Lexus December to Remember sales event for a limited time at your Lexus dealer.
Some of the festivities this week included the mariachi band.
Yeah, we're good. I want that suit. I'll wear that on the air next time.
That, along with your corduroy jacket, will grab the audience.
Well, we can wear. You can wear your WNBA suits that you wear.
First down, Baylor, after a big takeaway, fumbled by Polk on his 19th carry. Robert Griffin III will hand it off to Gannaway. A huge hole. The race is on. Gannaway inside the 40. He'll take it 89 yards. Touchdown, Baylor. A potential 14-point swing. Washington was in the red zone, turned it over, and then in one play, Baylor scores to pull it in five, and they're going to go for two here to try to make it a three-point game.
Making the right read on the zone read was the key to the play.
Do you agree with this decision to go for two here? It's midway through the third quarter.
I don't think it matters. I mean, you know, you're going to score points anyway. You go now or the next time you score. If you're not scoring points, it's hard to score points, then yeah. But if you're not scoring points, no.
And the jump pass. Said that he might be able to run the Tim Tebow offense in the NFL. That was out of the Urban Meyer Tim Tebow playbook.
But right here, it's a zone read. What do we see in the last series? Zone read, he kept the football, made bad reads. This time he gives the football, makes the proper read. The result is 89 yards untouched. You see the two-point conversion right here. Just the old Tim Tebow jump pass, actually made famous by a kid by the name of Moa that Urban Meyer ran against Air Force in Utah back in the early 2000s.
Art Briles went for two and his team within three. 17th rushing touchdown for Gannaway. And then the pass by Robert Griffin III to Monk 3-point game.
It all set up by the proper read of the zone read. Letting the running back get the ball, knowing that the last two times you kept the ball, Washington defenders were ignoring the running back and tackling you. This time he gave the ball. The results, 89 yards and off to celebrate.
Sankey elects to take it out. And he gets to about the 26-yard line. Boy, Gannaway at 240 pounds showed his speed on that 89-yard drive. You look at what Baylor's done in terms of scoring drives under a minute. Half of their drive tonight. That one was 11 seconds. Still not that long for a 245-pound guy to run 89 yards. Let's see how Pope responds on his next touch. He won't get it here. Play action for Price, and he's going to go deep for Carson. One-on-one coverage, and Carson's got it. Trying to fight off a defender. He's finally tackled inside the 15-yard line by Morton.
Right now you have the corner looking at the safety looking at the corner. We talked about it. With Baylor's safeties played at 8 yards of the line of scrimmage, Coach Sark is going to say, you're going to do that, we're going to do this all day. Now, if you know you don't have safety help, the corner right there in that situation, Ahmad Dixon has to play off and inside and take away the deep route. That's what they're going to do. The safeties are up, we're going to throw deep.
60-yard pass, and the Huskies are back in the red zone. Price is now over 300 yards passing. Price to the air again, to the end zone, touchdown. Devin Aguilar, his second touchdown of the ball game. Washington, that was an 11 seconds, but it was still less than a minute that it took Washington to score after Baylor got a touchdown.
Yeah, we're setting defense back about, I don't know, 150 years. It's unbelievable. It shouldn't be this easy.
You can't just praise the offense, Chris.
The extra point. And Washington's got 49 midway through the third.
I can't praise the offense or defense. It's awesome. It's fun to watch. Play off and inside. You have no safety help, forcing the outside throw, or Keith Price will make you pay. 900 yards of offense. I'm not praising any offense. Bad defense.
Alamo Bowl record, 88 points combined, and we still have at least 22 minutes of game action to go. Midway through the third quarter, Price has 4 touchdown passes, 2 rushing touchdowns. RG3 has a touchdown pass and a rushing score as well. You said 1,000 yards and 100 points combined. We might hit that by the end of the period. In fact, we're already over 1,000 yards, as we'll show you in a second. As Goodley takes it out to about the 26-yard line. In fact, we're at 964, so we're just shy of 1,000. The FBS Bowl record, which likely is going down tonight, was set at the 2005 Insight Bowl between Arizona State and Rutgers, 1,211 yards.
Closest thing that I've seen to an arena football game in a long time. So you might want to start thinking about onside kicking to get your offense the ball back. Maybe give up a 3, play good red zone defense. Now that might sound a little crazy, but I think you have a better chance of stopping them because they have less field to work with. You use the back end zone line as a 12th defender. And then that goes for both defenses.
Here's Tevin Reese, and he's got a seam. Reese almost to midfield, 23-yard gain, or he's brought down by Justin Glenn. Glasgow Martin of the game at tailback as Gannaway's getting a breather. Griffin going to throw it deep, got a man there. Overshot Kendall Wright, who beaten his man, Desmond Trufant.
Part of the offense is the double move right here, Kendall Wright. Little hitch and go. Desmond Trufant gets caught. 9 times out of 10, that ball's on the money, especially to the explosive Kendall Wright. Double move is a major part of that offense. True fun. Keep them in front of you. See the screen pass open over there, Dave? Look how far the corners are off.
Stead Ganaway running downhill into Washington territory for about 4 yards. Dennison on the stop. Now somebody made a tackle there. And Dennison has got 15 stops.
Tough duty.
Third and 7.
Four down territory, by the way.
Where isn't it four down territory?
Well, back inside the 20. But you saw where they punt what happened. They gave the ball back to him for about a minus 2 net.
They're taking the play clock down to 10. That's unusual for them. As RG3, strike down the middle of the field to Norwood. And they're trying to strip the ball. Norwood able to hang on to it to the 25. It's a 22-yard pickup. First down, Baylor.
Here's why he's an NFL quarterback, because he can make that throw. Stand tall in the pocket. Keep his eyes downfield. Not bothered by people coming at his feet. And that ball gets there with zip, velocity, and a nice tight spiral.
17th play of 10 yards or more. Salubi on the run. Inside the 15. Inside the 5. And Salubi is in. Touchdown. His third of the game. Let's see if he got in. He stepped out of bounds, but you couldn't see the ball from that angle. Does the ball cross the plane before he steps out?
It'll be close. If he's not in, about an inch short.
Timeout on the field. On the previous play, the ruling on the field was a touchdown. The previous play is under further review.
Now, you saw there where our guys just had it stopped, and from that, it didn't look like he was in. It looked like you see the foot out and the ball is still short of the goal line there.
From that angle, the ball's in the right hand. The ball's on the in his right hand, and from that angle, again, we can't see it. The official up top has the best angle because the official down here cannot see where that ball is.
As you said, even if he's short, it's first down and goal from, you know, the half-yard line.
You might get a goal line stand.
Are you being sarcastic now?
No, I'm not, because, you know, you can have a fumbled snap. And here's your best angle right there. So he's, with that right foot was out of bounds, and the ball did not cross the plane, so we'll probably come back and mark at the imaginary half-yard line.
Got to be indisputable video evidence to overturn the ruling on the field. I want to go back to what you were saying about Robert Griffin III and why he's an NFL quarterback and some of the throws he's made. You and I had him in the bowl game last year. Well, he looked good. I don't know if he made those kinds of throws in the bowl game. Seems like his can your arm strength improve that quickly?
I think he always kind of had that lie. I've heard guys describe it different ways. A live arm or like a whip where that ball just comes out. But what he's added to his game to me is he's much more accurate at the 13 to 17 yard pass to the deep ball. And he doesn't miss. I mean, we saw tonight how many passes he missed bad. Maybe the long one to Kendall Wright on the run was the only one that he really missed bad. Every other ball was a catchable football.
Does it not seem like there's more velocity though on the throws than there was at the end of last year?
But even though I go back to 08 when I saw him against UConn.
It was determined that the runner stepped out at the 1.5 yard line. The ball being placed at the 1.5 yard line, first and goal.
Now, great job there by the replay crew. Andrew Panucci, right on it, just short.
Well, the only thing is here is now, they execute it well, but he's got to take, he'll probably sneak it, and he's got to usually take the snap from center, from under center, which they're not used to doing.
We've seen him under center maybe 3 plays so far. And they're in as Ganaway takes the handoff and gets it across. Touchdown, Baylor. Second for Ganaway, and they both come
here in the last 2 minutes. Had an 89 yarder. That one's more his style, a 1 yard run. And they'll go for one here. Try to get within three. 6 minutes to go in the third. And it's 49-46, Washington. Capital One Bowl week continues Friday. A full day of college football at 10 Eastern time. It's the Insight Bowl from Arizona, Iowa, and Oklahoma. Capital One Bowl week on ESPN, ESPN3, also streaming live on watchESPN.com and the Watch ESPN app.
Tough loss for Iowa with Marcus Coker not playing in that game. Very physical back.
And you wonder about Oklahoma and its motivation, used to playing in BCS bowls, now playing in a non-BCS bowl. Well, Robert Griffin III will get a breather for a moment. It'll be Keith Price's turn. Price has accounted for 6 touchdowns in this game, 4 passing. He's thrown for 332. He also has 2 rushing touchdowns.
He's a good young player, quarterback that probably a lot of people haven't had a chance to watch play live. He's really impressed us tonight. Me for sure. I think you too, Dave.
Absolutely. As that kick goes out of bounds, so it's going to be excellent field position here for Washington. That's the last thing you need this kind of a game. Let's go to the studio and check in with Ryan Burr.
All right, Dave, here's your Sports Center right now. NBA action. Oklahoma City undefeated on the year. 1.4 seconds to go. Kevin Durant hits the buzzer beater. The world champion Mavericks have yet to win a game this year. Thunder are unbeaten. What a game it was. And the Champ Sports Bowl, Florida State scores 18 in the second half to beat Notre Dame 18-14. Sports Center follows our game. Dave, is there a third digit on the scoreboard by chance?
Well, it's computerized, so I imagine they can find a way. You might need to at this rate. 6 minutes to go in the third. And here's Polk holding on to the ball tightly with both arms, and he's close to the first down, greeted by Chadwick. You know, you talked about Price, and you think about some of the new coaches that are coming into the Pac-12 with Rich Rodriguez and Mike Leach, Jim Mora. Even though he might be more of a defensive mind, he's already had good quarterback play in the Pac-12. Do you think those guys are going to be able to go out and get some good quarterbacks? And obviously Barkley's returning to USC.
Well, there's a reason. I mean, the Pac-12 had a down year this year. That's why you have all the coaching changes that occurred in the Pac-12 and all offensive-minded guys, with the exception of Coach Moore.
Wow, wide open in the middle of the field is James Johnson. And he's finally brought down at the 27-yard line. Mike Hicks on the stop.
Well, I mean, to me, the players have no idea what they're doing, because you're playing a zone defense, and you can't be that wide open. You can't catch a curl route at 14 yards and turn and run for 10 more without being touched. You're not seeing the ball being thrown, and you're not breaking on the ball.
These guys got to be gassed, aren't they? Also, I mean, they've been on the field for
what, for a 40-second drive?
Man, but they're back out there after a minute. I mean, these drives are only 90 yards. Price with all day to throw, tipped through the hands of the intended receiver, Devin Aguilar. Incomplete. Looking at the bright side, Chris.
All right.
Combined points in a game, by the way, the record for a bowl game is 125. Marshall won by 3 in double overtime. We got 95 so far, so we're 30 away with about 19 and a half minutes to go. Second and 10 for Washington at the Baylor 27-yard line. Price finds Williams. Good defense that time by Baylor as the Bears flock to the football. Gain of only a couple. K.J. Morton there first, so it's third down and long.
A nice job on the outside by Ahmad Dixon defending the blocker, not giving one for one and coming up and helping on the tackle along the ball. They're playing their safeties up. They're set up for the double move.
third. Approach the safety zone, Dave, within 8 yards of the line of scrimmage.
They have to get just past the 17-yard line.
And they just moved Jermaine Kearse inside. They do that for a reason.
Play clock at four. Down to one, they get the play off. And Price gonna go deep and incomplete. Either Kearse or Aguilar, the intended receiver, hard to tell. The ball was thrown in between the two receivers. It's fourth down.
That's why I circled him. They move Kearse inside to run a route right here. It's kind of a post corner route, but he doesn't run the corner. And you see Aguilar, because Aguilar and Kearse are running together, bringing two defenders into the area.
Eric Folk, who's a pretty good field goal kicker, on for a 43-yard attempt, the first try for Washington in the game. And he missed it, wide to the left. So that's twice now inside the 30-yard line this quarter that Washington has come up empty. Once on a turnover, now on a missed field goal. Capital One Bowl will continue Saturday, a full day of college football starting at noon on ESPN with Texas A&M taking on Northwestern. The Meineke Car Care Bowl of Texas. Capital One Bowl Week on ESPN, ABC, ESPN3, also streaming live and watch ESPN.com and the Watch ESPN app.
Yeah, Baylor just broke Washington's serve. Let's see if the Washington defense can now break Baylor's service.
Baylor scored 21 in the first, 3 in the second, and 22 here in the third. Griffin in trouble from behind and dragged down by Josh Shirley. Played the game of his life with 3 sacks. Came in with 5.5 through the first 12 games.
Again, you don't want to blame Richardson too much on this because there is time to throw the football. They're trying to play action wheel route with Kendall Wright taking off down the field. Robert Griffin III. Again, if you don't have that right away, that's where you got to use your feet and run. Understanding that all night you've been getting hit from the backside because of the pressures from Shirley and Hudson, the two young defensive ends for the Huskies.
He'll hand it off here to Reese, looking for a running lane. He finds it, and Reese inside the 30. Defender trying to get the angle, and finally Reese pushed out of bounds inside the 5. Play took a while to develop, but Reese was patient. And he almost took it the distance.
Great blocking by the wide receivers on the outside of Baylor. And patience by Reese. Watch the blocking on the outside. First you have Niver doing a good job staying with his block. And right there, number 3 for Baylor, Sampson, staying patient, not holding, not coming to his guy. And allowed to Reese to hit that seam with great burst.
And some movement up front. The right tackle came off the ball, Ivory Wade. Penalty marker down.
False start. 7-9. Offense. It's a 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Robert T. Griffin also moved. He's the right guard. No relation to Robert Griffin III. Could be RG3's final college game. He has not made a decision yet. We talked to him yesterday. Said he'll talk with Art Briles' head coach and his parents afterwards. Did not file his paperwork yet and see where he might go. He said he didn't want to take away, didn't want to distract the program at all. And if you heard his Heisman Trophy speech, he talked at length about his school. Says he's all about Baylor right now. We'll see what happens after this game, whether he stays for a senior year or goes to the NFL. He'll hand it off here, and it's Salubi fighting for the goal line, brought down just short. So it'll be second and goal. Grant Gilliland on the stop. Salubi with 2 touchdowns already, had another that was called back. So Libby will line up in the backfield this time. Quarterback sneak by RG3. No signal yet. And he appears to be just short. So third down. And goal from inside the 1. You go back to the same play.
I do. I think it's your safest play. I mean, you're 4 inches away from the goal line. You've getting good surge by Phillip Blake, the center, all night. Go ahead and run it again.
They got to hurry with the play clock down to 5. Gannaway straight ahead. Touchdown, Baylor. And the Bears are back on top. Third touchdown of the night for Gannaway, 19th on the year.
Nice job again. Low man wins. Big front of Baylor do a good job and being lower than the defense in front of the Huskies, getting enough push for the big fella to take it in for 6. Gannaway.
Now Robert Griffin the third. Help Baylor get out to a 21-7 lead with a touchdown pass and a touchdown run. Then Keith Price went wild in the second quarter as Washington scored 28 points. We're now over 100 points combined. Over 1,150 combined total yards. And we still have the fourth quarter and 58 seconds remaining here in the third.
It's unbelievable that we reached 1,000 yard mark and the 100 point mark before the end of the third quarter. It's really unbelievable to me. But you know, you have explosion. Two good quarterbacks. But on the flip side, we have below average defenses. This is what you get. Shootouts in Texas. Seems appropriate.
74 plays run by Baylor. Washington scored 49 points running 50 plays.
The Old West.
Callier and Sankey are deep. And Sankey from the 2-yard line. Out to the 24. Well, this school that has a pretty good history of quarterbacks, BYU. Jim McMahon, of course, won a Super Bowl with the Bears. Had a good college career in Provo. Steve Young, Hall of Famer.
Talk about a dual threat. There's one right there, Steve Young.
Ty Detmer, one of the best college passing quarterbacks in history. And a guy working the sideline tonight, Steve Sarkisian, the head coach at Washington, as Polk takes it out near the 29-yard line. Sarkisian led the nation in pass efficiency back in 1996. BYU takes on Tulsa tomorrow, by the way, in the Bell Helicopter Armed Forces Bowl. And a quarterback on the other sideline, Robert Griffin III, leads the nation in pass efficiency this year, in fact, trying to set the record. He and Russell Wilson are kind of neck and neck for the NCAA record, which is currently held by Colt Brennan, what he did at Hawaii. Second and 6 for Washington, final seconds of the third. They go empty set here. And Price finds Polk. Can't shake a tackle. Grabbed at the ankles for a gain of about 2 yards by Williams. And that's the end of the third. We go to the fourth. What will the Heisman Trophy winner have for us in the final frame? The column on the left, the notable bowl records before tonight's game. As you see on the right in tonight's game, we're close to breaking all of them. Baylor has rushed for 408 yards, scored 29 points in the third quarter. Washington had a bad quarter, only 14 points scored after 28 in the second. They've got 511 yards of total offense. Baylor trying to win its 10th game, that tie school record. For the first time since 1980, they've got a 4-point lead as we start the fourth. And Price on 3rd and 4, got a completion to Curse. Price has thrown for over 360 yards, 4 touchdowns. He's also run for 2.
Well, you think the future is bright for that young man in Washington football. They get their defense straightened out. They'll be contenders for a Pac-12 title. Because he can play.
His receiver, Jermaine Curse, has 198 receiving yards tonight and a touchdown. And here's Polk, his 22nd carry, out to the 47-yard line for a gain of four. Well, clearly Washington is headed in the right direction, but again, you go back to the influx of some big-name offensive coaches coming into the Pac-12 with Rick Rodriguez, Mike Leach, Jim Moore Jr., hoping that he can get things turned around at UCLA. You got Todd Graham at Arizona State. Not to mention Oregon and USC already. Stanford. It's going to be tough as Price takes off and knocked down short of the first down marker by K.J. Morton.
You know, Cook Sarkisian's a big name out of the West Coast. Washington's a long way away. Seattle's not easy to get to, but he does a really good job. I talked to him about this. People know who he is out there. He can get Washington, Seattle, and they make their money in California. That's where they make their money.
That's where Keith Price is from. He's from Compton, sophomore. He's recruited by Sarkisian and his staff. See what his quarterback can do here on third and two. A hand it off to Polk, and he stops short of the first down by Gary Mason. So it's fourth and one. Do we even need to ask the question?
Well, I think you absolutely have to go for it. No question about it. Gary Mason did a good job of penetrating. A little bit of a run blitz out up there by Phil Bennett.
Washington, one for one on fourth down.
It'll be gutsy to call a little play action here, wouldn't it? Judging by the depth of Polk, the running back, it will be a handoff. Just how deep he is. 7 yards back. Gives him room to get the ball to make a decision.
And they'll hand it off to Polk, and he's got the first down to the 45-yard line. So if you see that, how come Baylor doesn't see that on defense, or do they see it and they just can't stop it?
I think it's the last. I think they see it and they just can't stop it. But that's one thing to look for in a team that has tendencies. Anytime that running back is back there about 7 to 7.5 yards, 95% run, and you got a play running as a linebacker, you can at least alert the defensive lineman with a rabbit call. Rabbit run, bird pass.
First down of the 45. And they'll fake it this time. Price has a wide open man inside the 20-yard line. Aguilar finally twirled to the ground at the 15-yard line by Morton. Another big play through the air, gain of about 30.
Well, this route takes a long time to run. It's Aguilar working all the way across the field. It's a double clear out, double crossers. Good protection by the Husky offensive line to allow Price to stand back there and let that route develop.
Here's Polk. And he doesn't get much. Hit first by Dixon. 25th carry for Polk. He came in with 769 for his career, and he's a junior. He technically could play one more season, although he has his degree. Could come out. Now, a lot of scouts think he'll be a second or third round draft pick. Play the drive coming up. It's been a 4.5 minute drive, maybe the longest drive we've had this game. Price going to his tight end, Safarian Jenkins. Beautiful moves. Got the first down inside the five.
There's a future all Pac-12 player, Safarian Jenkins. Again, the fact that Price gives the ball where his receivers do not have to work, and you see the true freshman not running out of bounds, being aware of where he's on the field and fighting the clown to get the first down.
First and goal from the four, as you see play 11. Over 5 minutes off the clock on this possession. Play fake for Price. To the corner of the end zone, overthrown. Williams got away from the defender. Joe Williams of Baylor, but the pass was overthrown. Second and goal.
So Keith Price right there working. Telling Casey Williams, I'll get you next time. It's a tough throw to make from the hash to the back pylon. One that he's certainly capable of making. Just missed him with the overthrow.
A new FBS bowl record for combined yards, 1,225. We're about 23 points away from tying that record, but because of the length of this drive, we may not get there tonight. Second and goal. Play clock at one. And the pitch, Collier going nowhere. Dixon drills it in the backfield. Loss of about four. It's third and goal back at the 8-yard line now.
Well, we have Chris Polk lining up fullback. The previous two times they did that, they handed him the ball. But we said they have an option play set up off of that. Baylor was not fooled, played disciplined football, kept contained from the outside in, sealed, made the deal with the tackle for loss.
Are you in four down territory here? You're at the 8-yard line. You run a play to put yourself fourth and
because you can't stop their offense. So, yeah, you have to be in four down territory. I am. Depending on what you get here now, let's see what happens here.
Price facing pressure. Moving to his right, gets a block, and he'll take off. He'll come up just short. No, he got in. Touchdown. How did he get the ball across? Wow. Third rushing touchdown for Price.
Watch his right arm. He's going to knock the pylon with the football in his right arm late, right there. A great second effort. If his feet are in bounds, then that's a score. If he's marked out of bounds, let's see where his feet are. The knees are up. Feet is still in bounds. That's 6 points. That's a great effort. That's knowing where you are on the football field and making a play for your team.
They're going to review this further. That's an incredible play. That's a touchdown. Looked like he was going to come up just short, and as he was rolling to the sideline, he stuck the ball out and got it across.
Not only a great play, but I'll tell you, a great call by the officials right here, as this will hold up as Jean-Baptiste comes in. Look at that. Feet are in bounds, having the awareness, and reaching that ball across the front part of the goal line. Remember, the imaginary plane runs up to the front of the goal line. The ball does not have to completely cross the whole goal line.
Right. And his knee wasn't down.
Great play. Great play. I love it. Effort.
How about this? He's thrown for 412 and four touchdowns. He's rushed for three scores. He's responsible for seven touchdowns in this game. Again, the ruling in the field is a touchdown. It's got to be indisputable video evidence to overturn it. And there you see, again, the ball is across the plane. And at that shot, he's not down yet. So it should be confirmed. Touchdown. What a great play. That was a time-consuming drive. 6 minutes, 18 seconds, 13 plays.
And now Washington's defense has to find something to adjust to. I still maintain, play your soft zones, keep the ball in front of you. But the problem is, they're not getting hurt throwing the football, but nobody's making a tackle. Nobody's getting off blocks. And you're seeing, as evidence, 408 yards rushing on the ground for Baylor.
That's a further review. The ruling on the field stands.
Washington back on top by two. Trying to win back-to-back bowl games for the first time since they won a national championship back in 1991 with Damon Heward as the quarterback. He's now the radio analyst for Washington. They got a pretty good quarterback right now, and Keith Price, seven touchdowns tonight. Over 65,000 on hand here at the Valero Alamo Bowl. Washington back on top by three. And coming up tomorrow, Capital One Bowl Week continues. You got the Bell Helicopter Armed Forces Bowl to kick things off at noon. BYU Tulsa, New Era Pinstripe Bowl, Rutgers Iowa State to follow. And at night, Iowa State, or the Insight Bowl rather, Iowa and number 14, Oklahoma. Also Wake and Mississippi State squaring off. Just a few days away from the BCS Bowls. And of course, the championship game pitting LSU and Alabama. Baylor down three. And the kicker Bears have got to be getting tired. Short kick taken by Norwood out near the 30-yard line before he's popped. Here's Quintessnan.
Dave, I'm standing behind the Baylor bench right now where their entire defensive unit, cold towels or guys cramping. Fatigue has set in for both teams. One thing, you know, Baylor has not been able to capitalize with a home field advantage here today. They have about 60,000 fans here. Their fans have really not been able to rally their defense. And that last drive, one thing you have to point out, Dave, Washington possessing the ball, giving their defense a rest that they very much needed after really struggling in the third quarter.
Yeah, that was a 6-minute, 18-second drive. Robert Griffin III, though, is also rested. Not that he needed it, but got a breather. And here he goes on first down, looking for running room. And gets about three before Gilliland brings him down. Did you ever play in a game like this as a defensive player? I mean, what is it like for a guy who's playing defense against offenses like this for 60 minutes?
It's frustrating. You can do nothing to stop him. I played in it against him. We talked about it. One of the great dual threat quarterbacks, Steve Young for the San Francisco 49ers.
And the deep pass down the sideline, and it's caught inside the 25-yard line at the 20 by Kendall Wright. There's the deep ball by RG3 on the money.
It's a matchup that they want. You see right here, Quentin Richardson does not get into a back pedal. Let's Kendall Wright get over the top of him. That ball was a little bit underthrown. Quentin Richardson has to be deepest the deepest. Let them go with the underneath stuff. Don't worry about it.
Here's a short throw. And oh, what a move there by Kendall Wright. We saw him make a guy miss in the open field and score a touchdown in the first quarter. That time he ducked under the defender and picked up about 9 yards.
I marvel at the condition that the receivers are in for Baylor just to run this offense.
Here's Gannaway inside the five. Stacked up at the four, it'll be first and goal for Baylor.
The only problem is that Baylor's defense is going to be right back on the field, gas and winded.
Now this drive has taken a minute and 16 seconds. 66 yards in four plays, first and goal. Gannaway, his fourth touchdown of the night. Baylor back on top. A minute and 25 seconds off the clock. Five plays, 70 yards, highlighted by that long throw by Robert Griffin III to Kendall Wright. Point after by Jones. And it's a 4-point Baylor lead as the Bears have hit the 60-point mark. Terrence Gannaway with four rushing touchdowns, and Baylor retakes the lead midway through the fourth. Tonight's game summary brought to you by Marriott Courtyard. Your television screen is working properly. You set the bowl record for combined yards. We're 9 points away from tying the bowl record for scoring. RG3 has rushed for 55 yards and a touchdown. He's thrown for 296. Price is accounted for seven, thrown for over 400. Baylor's rushed for over 400 yards. And we still have 8 minutes and 15 seconds to go. 60 to 56, Baylor.
Somebody's going to, it's going to come down to a turnover. Home serve is somebody coming down to a turnover. It's going to be a tip ball, a fumble, because it's the quarterbacks, I don't think, are making bad decisions. And frankly, the receivers aren't being covered close enough for anybody to break down a football and make a play.
Here's Sankey on the return for Washington. Dropped down at the 22-yard line. Here are the bowl records prior to tonight. We've already eclipsed one and tied another. And I'm guessing at this point we're going to pass the 125 combined points. How about 55 combined first downs in this game?
Wow, that's just amazing. I've never seen anything like it.
Who is going to flinch? Who's going to make a mistake?
Yeah, I see those Baylor safeties playing awful close to that line of scrimmage again.
The delayed handoff. Chris Polk brought down by Coffey. Not much by tonight's standards. Gain of a couple.
You see how the Baylor defense responds again. Cliff Kesnick, sideline reporter, told us how winded and gassed they were with the cold towels, oxygen, sucking air. This is where you're going to get mentally tough. New game starts right now. Somebody step up and make a play.
Here's Polk. And he keeps the feet churning. And will come up just short of the first down, brought down by Hall. You see Washington slowing the pace down like it did on its last drive. Third and two coming up.
Well, you think they're probably in four down territory.
No, at your 30-yard line with 7 minutes to go?
Have you stopped them? You might have you stopped them. That's my whole point. You haven't stopped them, so I wouldn't be surprised. Let's put it that way. Just think about that for a second.
They're not going to run the ball, and Polk is not going to get it. He'll come up short by about a half yard. Based on the spot there.
I'm looking at Coach. He's not looking for a punt team, is he? He's looking at his play call sheet.
So he's short. They measure here just to make sure, but based on that initial look, he's short.
Now think about this. Are you surprised that if he goes for it? And then you got the hard count to try to draw him off sides.
Well, the point here is if you don't get it, you give them a touchdown.
Yeah, but you get the ball back quicker.
Yeah, but now you're down two scores, and you only have 4.5 minutes, 4 minutes to go.
What's their average score? Think what, a minute?
About a minute, minute and a half. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm just saying, I mean, how the game is going, you got to realize that maybe you're not going to get another shot. The best shot is to go for it. Try to keep their offense off the field.
And remember, Baylor decided, granted it was in Washington territory in the first half, to go for it and fourth down. They didn't get it. And Washington scored on the next play. They get it to the line quickly, snap the ball, and Polk able to power past the marker and get the first down. Good hard run by Chris Polk on his 29th carry of the game.
So I told you it's fourth down territory, number 52. Nick Wood looked like he jumped the count a little bit as the pooling lead blocker. They might have got a little away with the one. It looked like he jumped. The left guard jumped on that play early. We got away with one. Take a look. Watch number 52 right there. See that?
Right, yeah.
He jumped. They got away with one.
Should have been a false start on Nick Wood. Instead, it's a first down and 10. Here's Calliers. He loses a half yard. Met at the point of attack by Terrence Lloyd. They have yet to see a pass play on this drive as Lloyd is shaken up.
Again, you never want to see anybody hurt, but one good thing it does, it gives the other 10 a little bit of a blow.
Now, it's been all run plays on this possession, which has taken 2 minutes and 28 seconds. Right now it's second and 10 for Washington. Do you like the philosophy here by Steve Sarkisian?
Yes.
Just try to make this a 5 or 6 minute drive so that if they get the lead back, then even though Baylor, as you pointed out, average scoring drive about a minute, minute and a half.
You can't stop him. You're not even close to stopping him. So yes, I like what he's doing. And again, going into that, there was no question that that was four down territory. Because of that, I mean, you got to put the hands on the strength of your team, give yourself the best chance to win. The strength of your team is your offense. It's paid off.
Keith Price has thrown for 4 touchdowns. He's run for 3. And he's in an empty set here on second and 10. Finds his tight end, Safarian Jenkins, who is cut down just shy of the first down by Coffey. It'll be third down and 1.
Now, if they go back to that power play, Nick Wood has been a little antsy on getting off the ball. Just keep your eye on that. That's when he pulls around from his left guard position to the right side of the line of scrimmage, becoming a lead blocker.
There you go. Two back and two tight end.
Wood is going. There he goes.
It's play action. And Price going to his tight end, and Seferian Jenkins with an incredible grab. He had a defender, Chadwick, all over him. But it's 6'6 versus 6 feet tall. The taller man wins.
Well, what I like here is the pass. Throw it above the defender, trusting the height and ability of your true freshman tight end to go up and make a good hands catch and have strong hands. Actually, good coverage by the defender, Chadwick, because he had his hands inside that football.
Fifth catch for Seferian Jenkins and a first down at the 41 of Baylor. As we near the 4 minute mark here in the fourth, Washington down by four. Play fake again. Price in trouble. On the move. And a diving attempt. And Aguilar unable to come up with it. Incomplete.
Keith Price limping a little bit. Catchable ball. Aguilar normally makes that catch.
Jermaine Curse, who has had a terrific game today at wide receiver. Shaken up earlier, haven't seen him in a while. 198 receiving yards and a touchdown. Well, Price has plenty of weapons outside of Kirk's. Second and 10. They'll run it, and Polk hit in the open field by Mason. If he didn't make that tackle, yeah, that's a huge play for Chris Polk.
Good job of Mason coming off the run read. Not getting upfield. Watch Mason number 10 at the top of the screen. See that? Just plain run. Not even having any pass rush involved. Stand down, settle at the line of scrimmage, shooting, making a good angle tackle on Polk.
Third and 8 for Washington at the Baylor 39.
Look at his target right here, the big fella, Seferian Jenkins.
10th play of the drive, Price. And an incomplete pass intended for James Johnson. Ruling of the field is incomplete. So it's fourth down and 8.
Yeah, good call right there. Ball was thrown forward. It's like a shovel pass. It's behind the line of scrimmage. So even though it's thrown forward, it's still an incomplete pass.
And Washington will go for it. Fourth down and 8 at the 39-yard line of Baylor. They are 3 of 3 on fourth down tonight.
See it, Baylor. If I'm Baylor, I'm gonna blitz. I'm gonna take my shot right now. If I don't get it, I got RG3 bring the offense back out on the field.
Timeout called by Washington. 2 remaining for the Huskies. Back in a moment to San Antonio.
ESPN College Football, the Valero Alamo Bowl, is brought to you by Valero, the all-American gasoline all across America, and the Capital One Venture Card. What's in your wallet?
Well, that last shot is a perfect picture to describe this football game. It has been back and forth, and it's come down to this for Washington. Fourth down and 8, trailing by 4 at the 39-yard line of Baylor. They're perfect on fourth down in this game. 3 of 3. Price to pass. Pressure coming. Price hit. Incomplete. Baylor takes over on downs. It was Gary Mason Jr. who got the shot in on the quarterback, Price, that forced the errant throw.
Well, they did that by rushing two. Watch the top of your screen. Mason coming off the top of your screen. Just beats with a speed rush to the outside. Only two guys rushing. You're getting 9 in coverage. Outstanding call. I thought he would have come with the blitz. He played double conservative. They played the stick routes. It paid off. Sorry, you got 320.
So you agreed with him taking a timeout there, take your shot there and fourth down rather than save that timeout for defense because you haven't stopped him.
I thought it was a great call also by Phil Bennett on the other side. Mason makes a great individual play, only rushing two, beats the left tackle, the right tackle with a speed rush.
It'll be Salubi on first down, makes a couple of men miss. And it's a first down for Baylor, and he stayed in bounds. The clock will stop as they reset the chains and the ball. It's the ruling that he stepped out at midfield. And, well, able to stay in bounds, so they reset the chains and put Griffin under center.
Let's see when RG3 snaps his football. Play clock is down at 18-17. Take your time.
Can Washington get a stop? Can they get a stop three consecutive plays? That's the bigger question. Here's Gannaway. And he gets about eight. Brought down by Parker. Washington has to use a timeout there. How about Baylor with three 100-yard rushers in this game? 441 yards rushing total for Baylor and 60 points. In the latest chapter, one of college football's great traditions, two high-octane conference champs meet in Pasadena, Wisconsin, and Oregon in the Rose Bowl game presented by Vizio Monday, January 2nd on ESPN. Chris and I will have the call on ESPN Radio if we still have our voices. You can also catch it streaming live and watch ESPN.com. The offensive bar has been set, Oregon and Washington. 1,356 yards of total offense in this one tonight, a new bowl record, 9 points shy of a bowl record for scoring, tying the FBS bowl record for total touchdowns. And a second and short for Baylor. Washington has one timeout remaining.
Better blitz, sell out.
Gannaway, first down and roll! Exclamation point! Touchdown, Baylor! Fifth rushing touchdown for Gannaway. 199 total on the day. A guy whose toughness was questioned by the coaches in the offseason. They said, you're 240 pounds, you have speed, you should be a better player. Well, he set the school record for rushing yards this year, and he now has 21 rushing touchdowns on the season. And Baylor has scored 67 points tonight.
You got to run blitz. You can't sit back there in a two-deep coverage. Then when you get manhandled up front and driven off the ball, and Gannaway doesn't get tackled if it's two-hand touch. It's too easy. I mean, everybody's getting kicked out, blown off the ball. You don't have enough people up at the line of scrimmage. That's the result. You got to sell out on the run, understanding the situation in the game. Lock up the man outside, get everybody else inside, and expect the run. Make them throw it. They're going to run it.
You said before the game you thought there'd be a combined 1,000 yards
a foolish
and 100
statement.
Points.
What a foolish statement that was. I overestimated the defenses.
This is crazy. Never seen anything like this before.
Never seen anything like it either. I mean, it's great. It's exciting. I'm seeing skill and talent and something to celebrate on offense, but I'm serious.
No, there's another
side
of this.
Have you seen defensive football like this in the Division I football schools?
Not in a long time. It's as bad as I've seen.
Not in a long time.
Still 2:28 remaining.
It's more points up here.
Right? Washington can score quickly.
Outside kick?
And an outside kick. So it's not over yet, technically. But again, it's a two-possession game. You need a field goal, touchdown, and a two-point conversion.
Watch them. I just want to tell you, watch. It's something to look for. Watch number 15 on kickoff coverage. He's been making plays all time, kickoff coverage, good hits.
Yeah, he's had a great day. One of the other men comes flying in. gets it. And he's out near the 40-yard line, and he didn't go down. And then the ball came out. He lost the football. Danny Shelton, a defensive tackle, rushed in there, grabbed the ball, then wouldn't go down and lost the ball. Baylor saying they got it. And they do. McCall with the fumble recovery for Baylor.
It's right here. You see our boy getting in there. Does not go down. Baylor smart, understanding that the big fella does not understand the concept of ball protection. So they start ripping at the football. That was a fight to the finish to get that ball in there.
Now can Washington keep Baylor from scoring again, even if Baylor just hands the ball off here? We'll see if the Bears have just take a knee or if they run offensive plays here. 2:16 remaining, an 11-point lead.
Well, they're missing a player on defense, so they're playing with 10.
And the timeout yet. Washington recognized it and called a timeout before the play. We're a couple of points shy of the bowl record for scoring. We've already surpassed the bowl record for total yards. So timeout by Washington. They're out of timeouts. So again, we're 2 points away from matching the record for combined points in a game. We've already passed it for total touchdowns and combined yards. Robert Griffin III, 295 yards passing for Baylor and a touchdown. We mentioned there are three players with over 100 yards rushing for Baylor. Griffin is not one of them, but Ganaway is. He's got 199 rushing yards and five touchdowns, including an 89-yard touchdown run. He's our Capital One player of the game.
He's going to get 200 here now. From Washington, really, I mean, get guys, look how deep their safeties are. If they want to throw a touchdown pass, fine, but don't let them pound the football. Get up there. They're going to run the ball. Start stripping. You have to get the ball out.
Robert Griffin III, perhaps his final college football game. He's a junior, but he has graduated. He said he'll likely wait till last minute before January 15th to make his decision. If you're him, other than just the fun of playing college football another season, do you see another reason to come back?
No. Baylor, you've been great for me. I've been great for you. Thanks for the memories.
Here's Ganaway. And Washington can't stop the clock. Tackled by Gilliland. And
I mean, he could. I mean, he's that type of kid that would come back if he feels obligated. But
you look at Andrew Luck, you look at Matt Barkley, their reasons were, hey, we can win a national championship. You can't really look at Baylor, can you, and say they're a national title contender?
No way.
So what would be the reason? He wins a bowl game. He wins the Heisman. What's left for him to do at this level?
He's spent 4 years at Baylor. He's been great for that university. He's brought Baylor football back.
Got his degree in political science. He takes a knee. I'll have to do it one more time. And if this is it for Robert Griffin III, what a season. Mr. Price will be back, and he'll be fun to watch in the Pac-12 next year. What a showing for him in a loss, accounting for 7 touchdowns, 4 passing, 438 through the air, and he also rushed for 3 touchdowns.
And you'll see him next year. He'll be much more of an explosive runner when he's healthy. But really an outstanding football player. He'll be fun to watch and grow over the next 2 years at that Pac-12 conference.
Griffin waiting to try to get it under 40 seconds before he takes a knee so they don't have to snap it on fourth down. And they won't. That's it. Live coverage of the trophy ceremony down on the field. Log on to ESPN3 coming up immediately following the game. Coming up next on ESPN at SportsCenter, Baylor gets its 10th win. That ties a school record. And they could finish in the top 10 of the final standings for the first time in school history in what could be Robert Griffin III's final college football game.
He gives his team a bowl victory, something they have not had in almost 20 years. Got to go back to the 1992 John Hancock / Sun Bowl. And RG3 is with Quint Kestick down the field.
Robert, you're down 18 in the third quarter. How were you able to turn this game around?
Offensive line. We ran the ball in the second half. I don't know, we had close to 500 yards rushing or maybe more. And Terrence Gannaway did a hell of a job.
What was it like to play in a game like this? Just incredible scoring back and forth.
I mean, it's unbelievable to come out here 67-56. I mean, this had to be one of the most watched television TV games of all time.
Baylor, 10 wins, first bowl win in 19 years. What does that mean for you?
It means a huge smile. It means all these people in here, they came to watch us put on a show. We put on a show and we did it for them, so we're excited.
Have you played your last game in a Baylor uniform?
I have no idea. I'm going to enjoy this right now with my teammates, and we'll get to that later.
When will you make that decision?
Pretty soon here, probably.
Congratulations on tonight and good luck.
Thank you, sir.
All right, that's actually different than what he's been saying, Quint. He had been saying he likely was going to wait until the final hours before making that final decision up to January 15th, but he said there he's going to make his decision pretty soon. We'll see. Robert Griffin III leads Baylor to its 10th win. They score 67 points. They gave up 56 and won by 11. Capital One Bowl Week continues tomorrow at noon Eastern on ESPN with the Bell Helicopter Armed Forces Bowl. Coming up next, highlights. That highlight package of this game is going to be 4.5 minutes. Coming up on SportsCenter. For post-game coverage of the award ceremony, go to ESPN3. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Chris Spielman, Quint Kestick, and our entire outstanding ESPN crew, I'm Dave Pasch. Good night from San Antonio and the Valero Alamo Bowl, where Baylor and perhaps Robert Griffin III's final college game beats Washington 67-56. SportsCenter, right now.